right. Good morning. Good evening, everyone. It's Thursday, December 10th, 2015. Calling the Hingham Selectmen's meeting to order. First matter is approval of the minutes. And I don't see any. So we'll move on to questions from the public regarding items not on the agenda. And then we will move on to recognize the ESGR, Chief Petty Officer German, Mr. Pelosa. Do I have that name right, pronounced right?
Peloso.
Peloso.
Carlos.
Would you join us, please?
Thank you.
And Chief Borowski, excuse me, I omitted to recognize you, sir.
Sergeant Healy.
Pleased to see you again.
I haven't heard that term in a while.
Those were the good things.
Indeed.
So, Mr. Chairman, Board of Selectmen members, and Town of Hingham, it's my honor tonight to bring with me, as you mentioned, members of the Employee Support and Guard of Reserve. I have with me tonight, as you just alluded to, the former Chief of the Hingham Police, Borowski. He is our senior ombudsman, and I have Mr. John Pelos, who is the area chair for the SGR. And the reason that we're here tonight is a presentation to the town, the Above and Beyond Award, which is presented by the ESGR state committees to recognize employers at the local level who have gone above and beyond the legal requirements of the Uniform Services Employment and Reemployment Rights Act, which we commonly call USERRA, by providing their guard and reserve employees additional non-mandated benefits. And I'd like to stress non-mandated. These are benefits which the Town of Hingham goes above and beyond to supply to their guard and reserve members while they're employed, such as differential in or full pay offsets when you lose wages when you're deployed overseas, extended health care benefits, and other similar benefits. The award is given in a limited number by the state committee to employers who have had at least one of their supervisors or managers recognized with a Patriot Award, which was presented to Town Administrator Ted Alexiades on December 15th of last year, 2014. Another component of this award, so they're in phases, they're in steps and stages, another component of this award guarantees that the employers will sign a Statement of Support, SOS. This recognizes that the Guard and Reserve members are essential to the strength of our nation and well-being of our communities by their unique value and leadership skills that service members bring to the workforce. The town again entered into this agreement on November 2nd of this year with an official signing. I was actually down in the Veterans Service Office. So tonight again, I'm honored to have with me these gentlemen, and I'll let them take it from here. John?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for having us. It's a great honor to be here tonight, and it's very important that we understand the thank yous. We have thank yous for receiving this award from the Department of Defense. Thank you also for the service members that are employed here in the town of Hingham. I think it's very important that the town is recognized, and also too with this award, as Keith had mentioned, there's only around 20 per year that our committee is authorized to give. The town of Hingham has received one of the 20 of these awards. It may be a little misplaced somewhat, but the overwhelming response of the town of Hingham to win the Freedom Award. But in order to get the Freedom Award, you had to have a Above and Beyond Award. We held off on the Above and Beyond Award with the return of Keith. We're very happy that he's home. We're very happy here to present the award to the town again. Thank you very much for your leadership on this. It's a very prestigious award, and again, that they thank you. I'll turn it over to Ski to say a few words.
Yeah. It's tough to sit beside two gentlemen. they said everything. There's very little I got to say. But I think the most important part up here is, I call them citizen soldiers, even though he's a sailor. And six deployments, and he had a lot of backing of citizens of our town that made sure that his family, especially this Winnet, were taken care of, and you folks were part of that. And you are the leaders of our town, and the award goes to the town. So may I read it? This is the Above and Beyond Award. Employer Support of the Guard and Reserve presents this Above and Beyond Award to the town of Hingham, Massachusetts, presented on behalf of men and women of the National Guard and Reserve Forces for outstanding service and continuing support to the national defense. And it's signed by the National ESGR Executive Director and the National ESGR Chairman. And may we go forward.
Chairman, job well done. Semper Fi.
Do or die.
Always faithful.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, gentlemen, for coming in.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure.
Mac, anytime. Merry Christmas. Thank you for the gift. You would.
They come and they go.
Smart.
I'd like to recognize also Mr. Asher as he leaves the room. He's on the Veterans Council, and this is a team effort across the board. So thank you. Thank you, one and all. Great work. That was enjoyable. Let's turn to something on the practical end of things as it relates to the gas main. Let's see, National Grid is here with the highway. Gentlemen, would you join us at the table?
Good evening. My name is Dennis Regan. I'm the permit representative from National Grid. And tonight, National Grid respectfully requests your consent to install and maintain approximately 345 feet, more or less, of 2-inch gas main in Lewis Court, Hingham. From the 2-inch gas main near Hersey Street, westerly to the end of the gas main at House 16, all of which to replace and abandon the existing 1.5-inch and 2-inch gas mains in Lewis Court.
Questions from my colleagues. Who would like to start?
I'll go first.
And everything is in order, Ted?
Yes.
And the abutters, et cetera? Everything.
Correct. We have no issues with both of these applications. I'm not sure if there's comments from the public, but staff-wise, Harry, do you have anything?
Nothing at all. Okay.
And this is being done because this is to stay one step ahead of the road building schedule, which is the practice that we've had in the town.
Yes, this is the BS steel gas mains that would be very well, we should be replacing them, yes.
Thank you.
I do want to mention that Lewis Court was only placed on the road destruction list when the small little cul-de-sac subdivision was being constructed. And after doing some research, seeing the age of the main, we called National Grid and they put it on their workload absorbed it in their 2015 budget to replace that gas main. So it was more of a favor than, you know, a long time planning, which we've been doing with them.
Is Lewis Court being rebuilt?
It will be. Once the subdivision is completed, the whole road will be reconstructed once the gas main's in place. And
right to Hersey Street?
Right to Hersey Street, yeah.
If I could just jump in.
Oh, no, go ahead.
In terms of the timing of the work, are we late in the year for this kind of work? That was my only question.
Well, the weather's being very cooperative, sure, for one thing. In order to, you know, get the gas main in, if the weather's cooperating, it will continue to work. As soon as the weather turns, you know, a deep frost comes in, or fall weather, work will stop, there will be patch and picked up again in the spring.
So as long as we're not dealing with a frost, we can still keep working?
That's correct.
Okay.
And even for frost, if it's light frost comes in, as long as they bring in, you know, material that's, you know, it doesn't have any frost in it, you know, it's still, you know, we're able to work.
Does the nature of the fill change at all, depending on the weather?
No, I mean, good gravel doesn't have a tendency to, you know, freeze up unless there's some moisture in it. It generally drains it free of moisture, so as long as it's a dry gravel, there shouldn't be any issues with it.
Harry, you said the subdivision being completed, so there's construction of some units going on in that street?
There's a cul-de-sac being constructed at the end of Lewis Court, which is the private section of the road. And that was, I believe that was paved this week with a binder course. The gas main installs under that section of the new section. I think there's three houses going in down there. That's all private, will be up for acceptance when this is complete and when the subdivision itself is complete. The lower portion will be up for acceptance for the town. We'll do an inspection at that time. And hopefully we'll meet inspections and it'll be a warrant for a town meeting probably a year from April.
When you say acceptance...
The entire roadway for public way.
Well, the Lewis Court right now is a town accepted roadway down to, I think, I don't have a distance here exactly, 345 feet, something like that, is a town-owned road. But the end of it is private. The last maybe 150 feet, whatever it may be. I don't have the exact figures in front of me, but that's now under construction for, I think there was one house there prior, and now there's going to be three homes.
Is it a hammerhead? Is it a hammerhead at the end?
No, it's a regular small cul-de-sac that's going to be constructed.
So the Lewis Court, as it presently exists, you said it's now that part of it, that it's existing, it's a public roadway now?
Yeah, the first 345 feet, give or take, is a public-owned road. And we plow it all, and then they turn around at the, well, they won't be turning around like now. In the past, they turned around in a driveway to pull out, and that was all private. I guess there was so much acreage back there, they could build three houses, which is approved by the planning board, and they're building it to an accepted townway. The entire length will be attached to what's already a townway.
And that portion of it is that the 345 feet is going to be repaved at some point?
Yeah, they'll reconstruct that road, not just repaved, but fully reconstructed.
Full depth?
Yeah.
And when was the last time that was done on that road?
Oh, I wasn't prepared to answer that question, so I really don't know, but I could probably give you that answer if you want to call the office tomorrow.
Yeah, well, is an older road?
It's been quite some time.
Okay. That pretty much answers my question. Thank you, Harry.
Questions from the public? Do we have a motion?
Make a motion to approve the request of National Grid to install and maintain approximately 345 feet of 2-inch gas main in Lewis Court. This gas main will originate from the existing 2-inch gas main near Hersey Street and continue under the paved surface of Lewis Court for the entire length to completion at house number 16. This gas main is replacing an existing 1.5-inch bare steel decayed main that is approximately 75 to 85 years old. This approval is subject to the stipulation of the Department of Public Works, including letter dated November 23rd, 2015.
Second.
Discussion, hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Yep.
National Grid hereby respectfully requests your consent to install and maintain 1,215 feet, more or less, of 2-inch gas main in Whiton Ave, Hingham. From the existing 2-inch gas main at house number 6, northerly to the proposed 2-inch gas main in Paige Street, and approximately 80 feet more or less of 2-inch gas main in Paige Street from the proposed 2-inch gas main in Whiton Ave, westerly to the existing 2-inch gas main, all of which to replace and abandon the existing 2-inch gas main in Whiton Ave and Paige Street.
No questions.
Questions, Paul?
I don't think I do.
Harry, is Whiton Ave on the schedule of roadways to be repaired in the upcoming year?
Yes, it is, finally.
Okay, all right.
That's good to hear.
And I take it that this is done in anticipation of that work, so you won't have to dig it up once again.
Yes, it is. They've been diligently replacing gas mains throughout that whole neighborhood over the last several years, and this is the last of the gas main that needs replacement, or expected to be replaced.
Good.
In the neighborhood.
Good to hear.
The little piece on Paige Street that we're connecting to, that eliminates 80 feet of bare steel also, so that everything will be plastic in the general area.
I don't suppose you have any sense of what the water lines are in that particular neck of the woods, do you?
I don't, but we haven't had any leak history in that area. It's a little more difficult to pinpoint gas main, water main. Gas main is a regular steel pipe, ductile iron pipe for water generally is, you know, lasts a lot longer. I think if there's any problem with that water main up there, we'd see, because the frost really gets into that clay drum on that clay soil up there and really moves. So it's either plenty deep, or it's not affected, or it's in good shape and takes the beating of the frost. And last year was a good frost test.
Are those similar soils to Baker Hill?
Yes, it is. They're both clay drum ones. The side light is, when we do reconstruct that road, as we did Bradley Hill, from Bradley Park, Otis Hill, two other clay drumlins, we put slope drains in on the positive side grade of every hill to grab any runoff from the water coming off the hill and discharge it into the drain system, so we don't have to replace the subbase of the road.
And that's working?
Yeah, as long as you keep the clay dry, it acts as a good subbase, but as soon as it gets wet, that's when it expands and cracks and you have problems.
Okay, good to know. I have a motion from one of my colleagues, please.
Sure. Motion to approve the request of National Grid to install and maintain approximately 1,215 feet of 2-inch gas main in Whiton Avenue. This gas main will originate from the existing 2-inch gas main at house number 6 and continue under the paved surface of Whiton Avenue for the entire length to completion at the intersection with Paige Street. This gas main is replacing existing 2-inch bare steel decayed main that is approximately 90 years old. This approval is subject to the stipulation of the Department of Public Works, including letter dated November 23, 2015.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
Merry Samuel. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, boy. Yeah.
All right.
That's what they say in small print. All right, at this point in time, we'd welcome the Cable TV Advisory Committee to join us at the table. We're a little behind, but we'll try to catch up. Good evening, Ms. Peavy.
Good evening. Thank you for having us. I'm Sandra Peavy, 204 Linden Ponds Way, apartment 310, chair of the Cable TV Advisory Committee, and with me is another member of the committee, David Jones. I don't know his address.
19 Lafayette Avenue.
Welcome. Okay.
Nice to see you.
We provided a memorandum to you, and it has 5 items. The first 2 are related. That is the retention of a cable attorney to assist with the renewal of the Verizon and Comcast licenses. Those licenses, I know it seems like a long way off, but under the state's plan for renewal, there's a 3-year time period in which there are lots of things to do. The Verizon 3-year period started last April and goes through April of 2018, and we'll have to have the Verizon license, cable license, resolved by then. The Comcast license period will start August of 2016, and the present license will expire August of 2019. So we're going to be working on both of them at the same time, but we're starting with Verizon. We need a lawyer to help us. There are lots of rules and time periods and things you have to do by a certain time and in a certain way. And William August has been helping us out since probably about 2009, and we've been satisfied with his services, and he's one of, I think, 3 cable attorneys in the state, so we don't have a big choice, but we're happy with him, so that's not really a problem. He certainly is well-respected and knows his stuff. So we recommend hiring him. I think I have his charges in the memo and a rough estimate of total costs. They can be paid from the cable funds, which we get quarterly from the cable companies, and we have plenty of money in the in that account to cover all of this. And the second item is for the Board of Selectmen to delegate to the Cable TV Advisory Committee the authority to do all of these things, hold the hearings, prepare reports for your review, and hopefully you'll like them and you'll...
And the board has done that in the past.
Yes.
Correct. This is the same structure we've used. I believe Mr. August helped you last time.
No, we had a different cable attorney.
Did he come in right after or something?
He came in right after.
Okay, right.
Yeah. He helped us with the documents setting up the HCAM, Hingham Cable and Media.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah. So, and he also, the delegation of authority that we provided to you, he has approved that. And had some input into it. So I'm satisfied that it meets the legal requirement.
Okay.
So that's, do you want me to go ahead and do all,
sure.
All five?
Why don't you go with your presentation and then
okay.
We'll do the votes.
The next three items, number three is one that is supported by the school department and the school committee. And I only just learned why they call it edge equipment. We've been talking about it for months now, and it's been referred to as the edge equipment. And the reason for that, I learned at our meeting last night, is that it's installed at the edge of the iNet in each of the schools in Hingham. So somebody named it edge. But what it is it's equipment. If you want to go any further than my understanding, David is more technically astute than I am, so he can help on this. We have a very good committee with lots of different areas of expertise, so we cover everything among the five of us, I think. And what will happen is it will connect to the iNet and will actually be able to use the iNet for cable broadcasts. And this will allow broadcasts to be made live from any of the schools in Hingham. And that will be very helpful. The new middle school has some wonderful space that would make for good meetings, presentations, whatever. And we can certainly record them now and put them on cable TV, but we can't broadcast them live. The school committee in particular is looking for this equipment because it likes to have its meetings at the schools. And it, since we've been broadcasting their meetings, the public has gotten used to having them live. And so they really don't want to have to wait a day to get the meeting. So they haven't been having their meetings this year and last year at the individual schools, so they're anxious to resume that. This will allow that to happen. So it's $21,000. Seems like a pretty good price for what we'll get out of it as a town.
And we have a letter from Dr. Gallo expressing her support for this.
Oh, good. She told me she was going to do that.
She did.
And okay. She did.
Good. She came to our meeting when we were discussing it and gave her input.
I think she's very appreciative of the request.
Okay, so that is that one. The next one is another one she likes, and that is to continue the funding of a TV production class at the high school. We've been doing that for the last several years. Actually, we started before HCAM got going. We were funding all three of the classes. We've cut it down to one. But even though HCAM is providing very good training for the whole community, we think it's important that the high school kids, that you start them young and that they get interested in it. And these are our future cable TV producers. So it's a little over, it's $18,466. We got that figure from Superintendent Gallo, that will cover one TV production class for fiscal year 2017. And the third item also involves our educational channel. I don't know whether you recall, but about a year ago, the Board of Selectmen turned over the operation of the educational channel to HCAM, and they hired a very, very good person who is in charge of that at HCAM. But he's been using his personal computer to do all of this, and this involves a lot of editing of movies, which is a big drain on a personal computer. And his computer is about to die with all of what he's been doing. And so we were asked by HCAM, could we fund a new computer for his use. It will not be his personal computer. It will be the town / HCAM's computer, but dedicated to the educational channel. And that seemed like the right thing to do. And that will come out of the cable operating funds. I talked that over with Mr. Alexiadis to make sure that that was the right account. And since personal computers don't last all that long these days, it seemed to fall within the guidelines.
Okay.
So.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Are there any questions on any of these five?
I'll start with Mr. Gannon.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Jones. I actually happened to be speaking to Todd Gallo, and she reiterated that she was supporting those projects, and obviously they've been successful in the past, and we appreciate you incorporating the schools into the technology that's available to HCAM. We appreciate that. In terms of the votes that we'll take, are the funds that are going to be used, are they all cable operating account funds?
Except for the edge equipment.
Okay.
The edge equipment will come from the cable capital funds, and those, we have come to the end of receiving them. We received the last check this year from Verizon. There were capital funds that were provided by the as part of our negotiations the last time from both Comcast and Verizon, and we keep them in a separate account. The town keeps them in a separate account, and we use one for the one for capital after the edge. I think that's going to be down to about maybe $60,000, and we'll have to stretch that out until the new contracts, when hopefully we'll be able to negotiate some replacement money for that. The operating funds are a percentage, 4.2% at the present, from Comcast and Verizon's 4.2% of their revenues in Hingham from cable. It doesn't include their telephone and internet. It's just their cable, but it includes all of their cable-related income. And that comes in quarterly, and that goes into a different account. And it's used to fund HCAM's operating costs. It will be used to fund the high school class and the computer. So it's used for smaller things and anything that comes under the operating rubric.
This may be a question for Ted, but also maybe for you. Just in terms of the attorney fees, I know I was looking at some presentation. There's certain estimated amounts.
Yeah.
Are we voting on an amount, or are we just going to authorize?
The Board of Selectmen has to authorize the council to be hired, not the amount, because we don't know the amount yet.
Right. So he bills at $200 an hour. Right. That we know. That's his billing rate. This is really a rough estimate, because we asked him, you know, what are we talking about? Because we've got this account with funds in it, and we wanted to make sure that there wasn't going to be a problem.
So I had asked Sandy to make sure that she get that. Even though you don't vote the amount, I had a feeling you were going to ask me or her, how much do we think this will cost? So I asked them to put together an estimate. As you know, we're doing an estimate on legal expenses on a negotiation of a cable contract with two cable operators. There's a few variables there. So it has to be a little rough. So, but the most important part is that you're authorizing the rate, the hourly rate, and the appointment of Mr. August.
It's helpful you gave us an estimate, and I thank you for that. Okay.
You know, I would first of all just say thank you for putting this package together. It was really easy to understand.
good.
And I know a lot of times with these things, they can get complicated, and really very much appreciate it. Because it was so clear, I don't have any questions, but I wondered, you know, you have a wonderful committee of folks who are going to be working pretty hard over the next couple of years. Sandra, could you just, the other members of the committee, could you just name them for,
yes,
for purposes of the audience? Because
sure,
many of these individuals have been working very hard on this for a long time.
Yes. Eric Connerly, he's our financial expert, and he's been on the committee. He was on it through the last negotiations, as was I. And he's amazingly helpful, and he also is our secretary, and he takes wonderful notes, which is also very helpful. John Rice is another member of the committee, and he has a lot of technical expertise involving TV production. And then Sky Thaxter. And Sky Thaxter was on, he was the school representative when I joined the committee, or just before I joined the committee. And when he taught at the high school, he taught media at the high school. And he came back on. We were very happy because he's been very helpful in working with the education part of this, working with the teachers and Doug Gallo and the HCAM educational coordinator. So he's got a lot of expertise on that. And well, that's the five of us.
That's us.
Right? The and committee when actually, we looked at this. Actually, Sky went to the Selectmen's office archives. He knew where to look and found the original
bylaws
setting up the committee. And it's actually authorized for 9 people on the committee. We haven't really needed 9 people over the last few years. We did have, as I recall, we had 9 or close to 9 when I came on the committee for the other negotiations, the earlier negotiations. I don't know whether we'll be asking you for another couple of committee members, but it's possible when we get into this,
sure,
we may decide that, you know, we've got enough work, we need to spread it among more people.
Well, and thank you, and I think we would look to guidance from the, guidance and input from the committee. These negotiations are complicated, they're long in nature. Continuity is really, I think it's helpful on many committees,
yep,
but particularly on this committee. So I just express my thanks to both of you and the other members of the committee for the great work.
Thank you.
I'd echo that. I do have a request.
Sure.
I used to enjoy just going on the website and clicking the meetings and streaming them in. I can't do that anymore. I'm not sure why. Mm. So now I zip around over at YouTube, and
you get them off of YouTube.
Sometimes I can figure out the terms that are used to describe the dates of the meeting, and sometimes it's a little more challenging. I would encourage the cable folks to use the HDTV technology to the greatest extent possible for these public meetings. I just think it gives a better quality, and it adds to the appreciation of what's being presented, especially when there are charts shown on the screen or plans such as, you know, those that are submitted by applicants in planning board and ZBA meetings.
Thank you, and that will be helpful. That statement of yours is very helpful. We have not been able to get Comcast and Verizon to provide HG service for the public access channels. I mean, they don't want to do it. However, it's going to be a big part of our negotiation. It's something that we want very much.
Strongly support.
We
that.
Think that we're entitled to it. And John Rice has taken on.
He's on that one.
And he's taken that on as his personal. I don't think he's going to stop till he gets it. And we're just going to let him go with that one. And he's working on it already. So
all right,
we'll do our absolute best.
Okay. Well, thank you so much. Anybody in the audience want to chime? Let's get to votes then.
I'll make a motion to authorize the Cable TV Advisory Committee to carry out the activities required by the Massachusetts Department of Telecommunications and Cable during the cable television license renewal process including but not limited to holding public hearings, ascertainment of the town's cable needs, negotiation of license provisions with cable providers, Verizon and Comcast, and making recommendations to the Board of Selectmen of agreements for license renewal and cable provides, all subject to the Board of Selectmen's rights and authority.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We're going to move right to the next vote.
Please, if you would.
Move to retain William August to assist the town in the Verizon and Comcast cable license renewal process at a cost of $200 per hour. Total licensing process is expected to extend from the present to August 2019, when the current franchise with Comcast expires. These funds will come from the cable account.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'll make a motion to authorize the purchase of equipment at a cost of $21,000 that will allow live cable broadcasting from the middle school, high school, and four elementary schools. These funds will come from the cable capital account.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Make a motion to fund one TV production class at the Hingham High School in fiscal year 2017 in the amount of $18,466. These funds will come from the cable account.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'll make a motion to spend $3,500 from the cable operating account for a computer to be used in producing and editing programs for the educational channel.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Well, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank
both
you again.
Thank you.
Thank you for the work you're doing.
Thank you very much.
HD.
HD, you got it.
That's what I like. Okay, we're a little behind schedule, but not too much. At this time, I'd invite the town accountant, the audit committee, and the independent auditors to join us at the table. I believe that's Mr. Melligan and Powers. Did I have that right?
How are you? See you.
Good. How are you?
All right. Chairman of the Audit Committee. Good evening.
Hello.
Good evening. Good evening.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Okay, so where do we begin?
My name's Josh Gregory. I'm the chairman of the Audit Committee. As you know, the Audit Committee is charged with the responsibility to review the audit process, including the annual financial statements and reports prepared by our auditors. I'm happy to report that the fiscal year 2015 audit for the town of Hingham is complete. I'd like to express deep appreciation to town administrator Ted Alexiadis and town accountant Sue Nickerson for their terrific help during the year in helping to complete the audit, and also to congratulate them on receiving for the 18th year in a row the Government Finance Officers Association Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting for the year 2014. So that is terrific. The Audit Committee reviewed the Town of Hingham's audited financial statements for the fiscal year ended June 30th, 2015, and met with Powers and Sullivan, the Town of Hingham's independent registered public accounting firm, to discuss those financial statements. We met four times during the year. The Audit Committee reviewed the following Powers and Sullivan reports. Their report included in the Town of Hingham's comprehensive annual financial report for the fiscal year ended June 30th, 2015, related to its audit of the financial statements of the Town of Hingham. Their consideration of the effectiveness of internal controls over financial reporting, and their federally mandated single audit report. The management letter prepared by Powers and Sullivan did not identify any deficiencies in internal controls that are considered material weaknesses. There was no disagreement with management, and the financials were prepared in accordance with acceptable accounting principles. And that is the extent of our report. I'm happy to answer any questions, as is Mike and Sue. And let me also introduce Mike Nelligan, who is a partner with Powers and Sullivan.
Good evening again.
Hello.
Good evening. Mary, would you?
I
anything you want to
No, you know, I read, so I read the report, I read the couple of the points. It seems that the town's response and the actions that the town was taking on a couple of minor things was satisfactory, so.
I'd like to thank you for your work, and I'd also like to recognize town accountant and town administrator for the work that they did here as well. Thank you so much for doing this.
May I just ask, just because we don't always have the opportunity to have the audit committee here, and you know, since we do have the audience, maybe we could just speak to the role, you know, we have an accounting firm that reviews and audits our financial statements, but maybe we could just sort of, for the benefit of the community, speak to the role that the audit committee plays, because it's important, especially for a town like ours with a $100 million budget.
So the audit committee is a recent addition to our, I would call it our internal control structure. The audit committee is charged with recommending to the Board of Selectmen an auditor to be hired. They actually manage the process to select the auditor. Previously, it was done by the town administrator through the Board of Selectmen. And you know, I felt as an accountant, background with accounting, is that that's a nice little bit of control that it differentiates. They're essentially supposed to audit management and our management's preparation of the financial statements. So I think having a little arm's length from that and not being the person who hires the person who reviews me and all the records of the town is appropriate. And so we recommended that to be put in place, and it's, 6 or 7 years now. And so it provides citizen input and an oversight, and it's generally a good practice. A lot of corporations use that same philosophy because you need a check against management over time. And so, you know, that is their role. They also oversee the audit process to see what's going to be examined, and if they feel things should be looked at, if they feel procurements need to be focused on or other aspects of our financial structure, that's what they go through. And it's another avenue for, like I said, the auditors to speak independently outside of management to a body in the town. I think that's essentially what their role is. And if I could just add a little bit about the financial statements. They mentioned GFOA. That's a national organization. Hingham is one of the few towns that do this. To me, this says that the financial statements are at the highest level in the country. And I think that's what the town expects. The one thing I will add is that I heard thank yous to me from the board and from this group, and I would say those should all be directed to Sue. You know, every year that goes by, my role in this becomes smaller and smaller and smaller appropriately, and Sue's role continues to become larger and larger, and you know, we consult and she talks to me, but it's nice to see that this is really her product of her work, and I wanted you to recognize that. You're welcome.
Definitely.
Duly noted.
Yes. Thank you, Sue.
Thank you. All right. Well, are there any questions, comments from the public? How about a vote?
All right, well,
Sue?
Sure.
Sure.
Can you
show
the picture?
Oh, okay. Show it to the audience.
Yeah. I just wanted everybody to see
this. Every year, this is probably one of the hardest parts of the CAFR, picking the picture that we're going to put on the cover that represents the year for the town. Bob, well, we put it on the sheet, and it shows the Freedom Award.
And I would just say, for, you know, for the benefit of the public, a lot of times people ask about, you know, the information about the town. They'll say things like, you know, how many, what's the population? How is our tax money spent? Where does our revenue come from? How much is in our rainy day fund? And all of that information, I'm sorry, Bob. He just got on the screen, and I had the nerve to pick it up.
It's the back.
All of it is contained in what's called the CAFR, which is the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report. This is a document that when you go to the website, you can actually download the entire thing. The statistical section, I think, is particularly informative. It talks about things, in addition to what I mentioned, things like who are the largest contributors to our tax base? It provides employment information, so it really does provide a helpful snapshot for the town. And I would say that many of us who volunteer in the town refer to that document in so many ways during the year. So when it's published, it's not one of those documents that's put on the shelf. It's really a very, very helpful management tool that we can all rely on. And the benefit to the public is that it is available to you as well. It can be downloaded, downloaded right off of the website.
And one last thing, it seems like we have a plethora of awards, but I want to make sure that we say it again, that we're proud of you folks. And 18 years in a row of excellence is quite an accomplishment. I want to make sure people at home understood that we're proud of that.
Okay. We have a motion.
Make a motion to accept the financial statements and management letter as submitted.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Well, we're going to begin your budget hearings now.
Yes.
And we're going to keep Sue right here with us.
All right. Good.
Were you going to start with the forecast?
I'm going to start with an overview. We last week, we jumped right into the budgets. You guys were so anxious, and we all forgot about the overview. Okay. In the front of your budget books is the first page, of course, table of contents, and it walks you through some sheets that we use to help describe the budget, the introduction, the operating budget recommendation narratives that I've given you, my recommendations in a spreadsheet form, five-year forecast, new growth, state aid analysis, 10-year history of local receipts, 15-year debt schedule, which includes excluded and non-excluded debt, and also a 10-year history of snow removal. And what I will do is just draw your attention for an overview of this year's fiscal 17 budget to page Roman numeral 14. Y'all know Roman numerals are not my specialty. It's numbers were meant to be, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You see me counting my fingers, it's probably because there's Roman numerals in front of me. Okay, so the five-year forecast. We should have put one on for Bob. I don't know if he can see that.
Do you want the forecast?
I don't think they're going to be able to see that if we put it here.
It's not HD.
Well, exactly, Mr.
Here we
Healy.
Go.
Yeah. You just won't be able to see the numbers. Bob, do you want me to try to put that on the sheet for you? I can speak to that.
Do you want it? That okay. Way you can speak to yours.
I can do either way.
So we're
in the center column on this report, which is going to be really difficult for people to see at home. Revenue for fiscal 2017 is projected to be $78,080,005 from tax levy. That includes an expected unused levy capacity. I'm assuming that you'll carry forward with the initiative from last year, and you'll maintain that unused levy capacity, essentially not taxing to the maximum law allowed under Proposition 2.5.
Ted, I'm just going to jump in and just say in 20 words that this represents the tax relief that was part of the middle school project that town meeting voted on several years ago. The increased levy capacity is a result of that. If that were to go away, the tax relief that we talked about would go away. That's important to know. That's why it's there.
Correct. The next category of revenue is a group of state aid, which we are forecasting to be level funded year over year. Local receipts, we're forecasting a modest increase. Predominantly, motor vehicle excise is the largest component of that, and we think that'll be flat this year. We saw an increase last year in that, so we're maintaining some consistent revenues there. The remaining aspects of our other total revenue include the country club's revenue, the sewer department's revenue, which are handled separately than other departments. The light plant continues to give us an in lieu of tax payment. And then the last item is the meals tax reserve. And if you remember last year, as part of the several years ago, as part of the middle school tax relief program and overall tax relief, we allocated $450,000 per year for a five-year period to ameliorate the effects of increased taxes due to debt exclusions, and we're using meals tax that have been collected in past years and allocating them over. So differentiation, we see that dropping off, and that's because that sum of money will have ended in 2019.
Ted, in the fund balance category?
Haven't gotten there yet, but okay, yes?
Oh, I thought you went down below with the meals tax.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. You want to go ahead? I'm sorry.
I just wanted to make sure. It has the number, it's zero at 17. I'm just...
So we don't budget fund balance to spend. And so in 15 and 16, we spent some fund balance, and we reflect those as actuals. But going forward, we're not building any budgets, assuming we will spend fund balance. But we do have a fund balance conversation to have this year, because there is fund balance above our threshold limits. Total revenue for fiscal 17, as it stands at this point in time in the budget, is $102,691,380. It is a increase over prior years, but it is the lowest increase we've had in a number of years. If you look in my operating budget memos, I give you the exact indication, but essentially revenue is increasing $1.52 million year over year, a 1.5%. So that ought to spell or foreshadow the budget process this year. If revenues are going up 1.5% year over year, it's going to be hard to manage expenses going up greater than 1.5% year over year. And so you'll see the challenges we'll have this year in the budget process. The reason for the decrease in revenue is predominantly in the area of new growth, and you can see that identified on the third line of the forecast. New growth for fiscal 17, we are maintaining at 550,000, and we're continuing that out through the remaining 4 years of the forecast. This is a decrease from 850,000 that we've been carrying for a number of years. Meeting with the assessors, it was felt that the development projects that we had in town were tapering off. While we had hopes that this year might be slightly higher than 550, those were dashed when the good news of 16 occurred. And if you look at the growth in 16, we have $1,178,494 of growth that came into the organization. That growth was anticipated at 850 for that year. And what transpired last year was a number of projects finishing earlier than we expected. So the good news is we got the money last year. The bad news is we don't have it available for us for this year in growth. And you know, I can tell you that while we have some building projects going on in town, most are coming to an end. The shipyard and Black Rock and Back River were our three larger residential developments, and those are tapering off. We have some small commercials, but nothing of a size that is going to begin to address some of our needs. You can also see that for the first time you're starting to see forecasts that are increasing in your deficits at the tail end, and this is a direct result of growth not coming in those years. We'll need to increase that economic value if we want to continue spending at this level.
And I would just add that one of the lessons that was learned from the late, you know, from like 2006, 2007 time frame was that when you forecasted new growth based on what you hoped would happen and not on kind of actual permit activity, you end up building a budget that you can't support. And so one of the lessons learned is to make sure that new growth is really as data-driven as possible so that we're not building a cost structure that can't be supported by the revenue.
So now we have our revenue of $102,671,380, and we now have our expenditures. We're forecasting $1,324,000 in other categories, which is predominantly our state assessments and our overlay account for abatements and exemptions. We are forecasting $2.2 million in capital outlay. This is a slot that we have allocated for budget. As you know, we started at $2 million and we've increased this. And you could see the $100,000 increase that we hope to continue on in the out years. Article 6, $99,326,739. The detail is on page 2, which I wasn't planning on getting into for the overview here. But I can tell you that that represents the departments, all departments other than the school department, as I've recommended them to you. As you know, in our budget process, I don't give you a school department recommendation. That is a process that occurs in joint meeting between the school committee, the Board of Selectmen, and the advisory committee, and you have a joint session coming up after the first of the year where you'll hear that budget, and ultimately those three bodies will vote that budget. It is included in the forecast at the 2% allocation that we started all departments in. So while as the town departments have shifted to their actual budget recommendations, the schools don't, because they're a little later in that budget process. I was clear with the school committee, and I want to be clear with you and on TV, I'm not suggesting the school department get a 2% budget. Their budget needs to go through the process like ours does, and all the town departments' budget processes have resulted in increases that are that vary from 2%. So, there's an Article 4 and 5 allocation of $389,351. That is expected contractual settlements with unions that we haven't yet started or completed bargaining with. And both town and school include portions of that in their budget as required to finance those activities.
And that, yes. From last year to this year, the coming year, it's a huge number. Is that because of what?
You want to answer that?
Sure.
Because you wrote the numbers.
I did.
That is because we've already put the Article 4s and 5 into the budgets above. July 1st, everybody got the 2% increase. Mm-hmm. So I took it out of the Article 4 and 5 and put it in their actual budgets on the second page.
I think, though, another way to answer, I think, your question is, if you look at the difference between 17 and 18, it's pretty similar to the difference between 16 and 17. It's about $400,000 a year. When you look at the town budget salary budget is $18 million, and a 2% increase on $18 million is $360,000. And so we usually forecast in that range.
And I just noticed a huge gap in the numbers from last year to this year, but I think Sue may have explained that.
So our total appropriations are estimated, and appropriations and uses are $103,240,537. So at this point in time in the budget, we're $549,157 in deficit. Now, $500,000 sounds like a lot of money. It is a lot of money. Maybe not so much if you made $100 million a year. And that's essentially how you have to look at it. We're a $100 million a year organization, and we're $500,000 away from a balanced budget. We've been able to balance budgets bigger than this at this point in time. So, again, while I know it's a large number and we have some work to get to, it's a surmountable number for us.
I would also point out that within the Article 6 budget is debt service. And the debt service that's in the forecast right now is only debt service for projects that have already been approved. So any, as we've been talking about different capital projects, those will affect the debt service. Maybe not so much in FY17, but certainly in the out years. And one of the things that this forecast suggests to me is that we're going to have to be thoughtful and careful about the pace in which we embark on large capital projects. I just don't think there's the room in revenue to absorb a couple big capital projects at one time. That was one of the reasons why I thought it was important to have the forum, was so that all of the different projects could start to be talked about, so that if we are making choices, we understand that saying yes to something in 2016 may mean that we have to say no to something else in 2016 or potentially defer it. There isn't enough money to go around, and when you debt service is not free. When you embark on a big capital project and pay it off over 20 years, it most definitely affects it. I think a $5 million project financed over 20 years, the debt service is about $400,000 a year. So if we add, hypothetically, a $5 million project for next year, that's an additional $400,000 in debt service. So it's going to be important, I think, that we keep all that in mind as we not only look at the operating budget, but we contemplate warrant articles and, you know, even, you know, seed money for design typically means that there's a project down the road. So I think we're going to have our work cut out for us in that regard, too.
And if you look at the debt schedule, which appears in the front on page Roman numeral 1XX, sorry.
Is that 19?
The debt service doesn't drop off substantially, and as you look, this is how I do my fiscal planning, the debt service doesn't drop off until 2021, actually 2022. And so, you know, you have, you know, some burden that you need to chew through, I think, to speak to your question. You're going to either have to clear debt off or figure out another revenue source before we just simply add debt to the table, because the budget numbers are too tight.
Did you want to touch briefly on fund balance? Because I think there's some there's some good news there. That
there's some really good news there. So I don't want to get to a tremendous amount of detail on fund balance tonight. We weren't completely prepared for that, but I did ask Sue to do one brief thing that I think an advisory, you know, we'll look at it in a lot more detail as you will folks will. We've given you some fund balance memos. We'll give you some more that get into a lot of detail about how fund balance is created and where it's come from. This year, we've seen a growth in fund balance of
okay, what chart are we looking at?
We're actually not looking at a chart right now. Sue just gave me a pie chart that I asked her to create.
That's fine.
So I'll just talk to all of you about it, and if Bob wants it, if he can get that on the TV for folks at home. So we closed our 15 books, and we produced an increase of fund balance, of unassigned fund balance. And we have several categories of fund balance, but for the purposes of this conversation, I think we just stay with the unassigned and assigned. Unassigned meaning, as it sounds, it's unassigned. It's available for expenditure by the town. It's not earmarked for any other purpose. And we added $4.3 million to that number. We were a healthy 20% of our total expenditures last year. All of that $4.3 million is not available, even though it was thrown into unassigned, because if we try to keep our financial policy of 16 to 20%, our denominator will increase and we'll get you the amount. But we suspect it's going to be north of $3 million. And what I'll tell you is this chart that Sue produced shows us how we added that $4.3 million this year. And it came from five sources. The bulk of it came from budget surpluses. So I think fairly self-explanatory. We had a number of budgets that the town approved at town meeting, and ultimately the departments didn't spend them. The largest of them was the school department with about a $500,000 increase. And we have the others, but the largest was the school department at that, and I believe we had a large amount from debt service and health care. The next largest category is a little bit of an odd category. It was proceeds from debt when we issued for our fire engines. And you say, well, how could you issue debt and increase your fund balance? Well, we actually spend the money, and then we have to bring the debt payment in as one lump sum, and it's considered revenue to us. We have an annual debt payment that comes as part of the operating budget where we fund it each year. So you know, that's considered a growth in our fund balance.
But so in a sense, this is what we will use to pay the debt service.
Except the debt service is built into the operating budget.
Built into the operating budget.
Okay. So.
Gotcha.
And we had planned for that before we bought the engines, because that would be appropriate. The next largest category, they're both pretty much the same, is bond premiums. And we received, they get my colorings wrong, I think I might have. Stabilization fund articles and, sorry, revenue surpluses. We received $653,000 from our revenue surplus. And so again, Our budget is based on a revenue budget and an expenditure budget. We had great experience in the expenditure side, and we also had good experience in the revenue side. Revenues collected exceeded our budget by $650,000. Again, those are both positive additions.
Ted, is that unusual to be that high, exceeding our estimates, or are our estimates not accurate, or?
No, not really. I mean, again, if you go back to the budget, we're talking about a $100 million budget. So if you have a $650,000 revenue surplus on $100 million, you're 99.4% accurate. So on the other one, I think on the revenue side, expenditure side, you're 98.5% accurate. And so we were talking about this in the school department. I thought the analogy would be appropriate. I'm really happy when my daughter comes home with a 98 on any test she gives me. That's a pretty good score. You're getting pretty close to the number. When you look at where those numbers are coming from, you know, the bulk of it came from the school department. That's a pretty big budget, and they can have large swings in terms of retirements and other issues and surpluses. So in terms of health care and debt service, again, those are trends based on economic issues that...
We're talking about revenue, though, right?
I was talking about expenditures and revenue at the same time. $653,000 of revenue is actually, I would say, small. $100 million?
It's not small to me, but it may be small to what you're referring
to. In terms of the scope of things, yeah. So if we bring the auditors back in, if you want to be cute with the auditors, you'll ask them what materiality is. And, you know, $650,000 on $100 million is broaching limits of immateriality, well, as long as it sounds.
I'm not saying, I mean, I don't know if I agree with that, but the point is, I guess the reason I'm asking is that it's always good to have exceeding estimates for sure. Is this something that is kind of a yearly thing? I mean, are we exceeding by that much every year?
Or? Yeah, I mean, AAA rated community should be producing annually budget surpluses and expenditures, revenue and budget surpluses. That's the mark of a well-run community, where you haven't estimated revenue above what you're actually going to collect, and you haven't planned on expenditures where you always exceed them. So,
and I get one last thing, Mary. But I, from year to year, like in the last 5 years, have we exceeded the estimate by that much? I mean,
I think it's been fairly consistent. I think we're seeing a little bit more increase. I mean, I think if you go back to 2009, hardly anything, because budgets were pretty tight. We were laying people mm-hmm. off, or not laying them off, but riffing them through not rehiring when people were tired. And so that process went through 9, 10, 11. Those budgets were extremely tight. And there was no room for margin, and you didn't see anything coming back, because we had asked departments for several years for 1 or 2% budget cuts. And while they have 2% inflation costs with personnel, that moved all that out. Last year, we saw some good numbers. The year before, I think we followed the economic cycle, usually a little bit behind it. So I would say you'd see these kind of numbers start tapering off now as you look at this budget, and you're $500,000 in deficit, and you got a 1.5% revenue growth year over year, you don't have a lot of flexibility, and you're going to start to see that get pigeoned down.
And I just want to make sure, because I mean, obviously, when I see that number, small to one person, large to another, and when I look at it and I think of all the things that we need to do, I just want to make sure that we're, you know, I understand that the downside is we might maybe in a deficit, but this is the preliminary point in time. I just want to make sure that we have the best estimates we can, so we can fund some projects that need to be done, whether it be schools or, you know, town or.
I would also point out, you know, on the revenue side, we close our budget. You know, our budget goes to town meeting at the end of April, and typically one of the big variables there is the state budget, and the state budget usually doesn't get settled, you know, until later on. And so again, you want to make sure that you're not building a budget, you know, hoping for a bump in state aid that doesn't come to fruition. So on the revenue side, that's one of the variables. And I would also point out that, you know, one of the risks that you have is that if you build a budget that assumes all the revenue is going to come in and it doesn't, we only have a reserve fund of about $500,000. And if that were to run out during the year, we would literally have to call a special town meeting to go into the reserve, so that's something we want to avoid. I would say one other thing is, in the past several years, our fund balance has grown for a lot of different reasons. We made a decision to not fund capital out of fund balance. Another thing that I think is a tribute to the department heads, many of whom are seated here tonight, is that I think we have department heads who are really good stewards of taxpayer dollars. And when it comes time to the end of the budget year, you know, I've worked in corporations where at the end of the budget, every department is looking to, you know, what can I buy? What can I spend this on? I know if I don't spend this, I'm going to lose it. And I think sometimes decisions aren't made that are in shareholders' best interest. We're very fortunate that we have department heads who I think pride themselves on returning money to the town. And I think it's very much appreciated. The benefit is that the other piece with fund balance is that every year, as our expense base grows, our fund balance has to grow by a certain amount in order to keep that ratio even. And some communities have to put a line in their operating budget to put money into fund balance. They have to literally put money into it just as it's an expense. Because of what our department heads do, we don't have to do that. So when we get to the expense part of the budget, you'll see a zero. And we're lucky because it's other communities sometimes do have to budget that.
That's a good point.
There was one last category I didn't mention in our five that added to fund balance. This is a category that doesn't always happen, but it happened last year. We received some bond premiums. We issued quite a bit of debt last year, predominantly for the school department and the middle school, but there were some issues for the town side, and we realized $343,748 of bond premiums. All the bond premiums related to the debt projects that were voted as tax overrides are not reflected here because we consider those to be assigned, meaning that we're going to put that money in the stabilization fund so we can give it back to the taxpayers. Because as you know, if you don't know, we'll explain, is that a bond premium essentially elevates or reduces the interest rate that you're charged. When we finance our homes and we buy a mortgage, frequently a bank will ask us to pay points, and we pay points to get a lower interest rate. Bond premiums are the exact opposite of that. The bond market or the purchases of our debt will give us extra money so that they can charge us more interest. And why do they do that? Because they're going to turn around and market that debt to consumers, investors, and it's better to sell a debt instrument that has a higher coupon rate. And so we realize that in the sense of debt exclusions, like the middle school or other projects that we voted in the polls, we believe that that money should go back to the taxpayers as an offset. Finally, the Department of Revenue agrees with us, and they've made that a law now that we have to return that money. In the past, they let communities keep that money, which ever since I've been working here, the town's never done that in 20 years. We felt that, you know, we shouldn't be charging taxpayers 4%, but and then getting a million-dollar bond premium. Essentially, the cost is 3.7%, but we get to pocket the money and use it for another project. I mean, that's just an end run around the taxpayers being nice enough to vote those projects. So we don't do that on that stuff. And this, though, is money that's within your operating budget. So I know that someone might ask me, well, how come you're not putting that over there? Well, the difference is this is money that you've built into your operating budget, and I think you could use it for a lot of purposes, one of which might be to offset your other debt. And that represents the pie, known as the increase from year to year. We'll give you the exact dollar amount within the next week or so, but you'll have some fund balance discussion to spend. We suspect north of $3 million this year that will be above the threshold that will be available under your policy for expenditure. And the policy does talk about the types of expenditures you should consider with that.
Yeah, just on that point, you say this year we'll have $3 million more than the threshold, which is what? What is the threshold?
Well, we have a threshold that says 16 to 20% of fund balance as it relates to and total annual expenditures should be set aside. And last year the number was 20.05%. We added about $4.2 million. And this year, while we can't use all that $4 million because, as Mary indicated, our expenditures went up too, so the percent's going to change. The denominator went up.
23.29.
We're at 23.29%, Sue informs me. We think that number is about 3.1 million, but we haven't calculated exactly, so we don't.
So for folks at home and...
Approximately $3 million out of will be available out of fund balance if you want to spend it, according to your own policies.
Okay.
And that'll be something that we would appropriate at town meeting if you wanted for, hopefully, a project that would, an activity that would be consistent with your financial policies. I will tell you, one of them would be, you know, we're not going to use that money for salaries, for example. The key point being is that it's gone. As soon as you use it, it's gone. It's not going to come back next year. So I think the policy speaks to, you know, one type of expenses, whether it's reduction of debt or payment of a capital project.
So that money, if it's used at all, would be available at some type of appropriation at town meeting?
Correct.
Okay.
Town meeting, we can only take money out of fund balance with town meetings.
I just want to make sure everybody knows that at home.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay, so that's the budget overview.
Before you do that, can I just put this up for 30 seconds? I'm just going to pass out. I'm not going to go through all these numbers right now.
Thank you.
I know you're disappointed. I just want to put this up on the screen, and we'll put this up on the website as well. But I think as the community is watching, and you're watching both the Selectmen and the Advisory Committee look at a $100 million budget, there's a lot of analysis that takes place leading up to a lot of these meetings and that really inform decisions. And this is actually a recap of Hingham operating budget trends. This is a document that that I actually originated with the Advisory Committee 6 years ago. And what it shows is it shows different spending trends. At the top, it shows what's been happening since Proposition 2.5 was enacted. That's actually been 36 years. I think the more meaningful information is in the middle. It looks at 10 and 5-year spending trends for different groups, so for general government, for public safety, for education, for debt service, for benefits. And the thing that I would just point out to my colleagues and to the audience is that for the last 5 and even 10 years, on average every year, our spending has gone up by about $3.5 million a year. Mm-hmm. And that's because we've had the benefit of new growth. There have been some debt exclusions. There was an override along the way. But that's what's allowed us the budget and the expenses to be able to grow. Now, remember that Ted told us earlier that right now, next year, he's forecasting that the revenues are only going to grow by about $1.5 million. And certainly that revenue picture can change. But what it suggests to me is that in the last 5 or 6 years where we've been in a position to be able to restore some services or take on some new initiatives, we're not going to have that as much flexibility as we have in the past. And then down at the bottom, again, just for information, oftentimes people wonder, you know, where do our dollars go? And down here at the bottom, what it essentially shows is what percentage different departments represent of the total town budget. And I think what you'd notice, and even going back further than 2006, is that where the money is allocated hasn't changed all that dramatically. You know, there are times when the debt service increases as we take on some projects. I think the biggest increase we've actually seen is in employee benefits, and that's due to both the cost of health care, and it's due to the fact that in the last 5 years we've been aggressively funding our OPEB liability. But again, the Advisory Committee uses this document to help inform budgets and to look at trends. Thought it would be helpful for you as well. Available on the website. Hope it's another tool for the budget process.
We can always count on you to come up with the numbers.
Thank you, Mary.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ted. Sue.
All right, you ready to get in the budgets?
I am indeed.
Let's do it.
Okay.
Let us commence.
Our first budget is going to be the accounting budget. It appears on page 6 of your book. And The accounting budget, the department requested $663,133. There were additional requests of $38,028. I approved those requests, and I've recommended to you a budget of $701,161. Represents a $49,179 increase year over year and a 7.54% number. I'll let Sue and Steve give you the details.
I just want to introduce Manager of Technology, Steve Becker.
Hi, Steve.
Hi, Steve.
Okay. The town accountant's salaries, if you see from 16 to 17, has actually gone down $10,000 for the request. That is due to a retirement at the highest step and the replacement coming in at the first step. So, which makes a good segue, because the $10,000 that we're going down, decreasing from year to year, we're requesting an additional half-time person in the IT department of $28,668. And if you have any questions, Steve is here to answer any of your questions.
Actually, why don't you just have Steve give an overview of the need for that, because I think that's one of the positions, this is one of the few positions we're looking at adding this year in the budget.
So I'll give you a little background. When I first began working with the town, I was basically responsible for this location, this building only. None of the other municipal locations were connected. We had three servers. Only a few people used the internet. Only a few people used email. So let's fast forward to now. We have 15 buildings connected over the fiber, soon to be 16, with the Harper Master location down at the shipyard. Users access the internet, applications, databases, email, printers, telephones over the network. They use workstations, laptops, tablets, mobile devices, and a lot of services are provided to the employees and the residents, GIS, financial database, including payroll, human resources, accounts receivable, dog licenses, business licenses, DPW work orders, permitting application databases. Telephone system is connected over that network with over 400 phones. Voicemail system. We have just on the town and library side, we have 230 desktops, 28 servers, two storage area networks, along with web content filter, message archivers, spam filters, backup devices, firewalls. And that's not even mentioned in all the switches, UPSs.
You want me to have them keep going?
Damn.
So,
your point's not lost.
Kate, our systems analyst, began 10 years ago as a part-time employee. She is now up to a full-time employee. And I can't say how instrumental she is in allowing us to do what we do with the resources that we have now. Her work ethic, technical knowledge, organizational skills have just been a godsend to me, anyways, to everybody else, I'm sure. So even with all that we perform on a daily basis, and we've had over 900 help desk requests in the last year from September to September, even with all that we do, that I'm still unable to do normal maintenance, monitoring server logs, telephone system, doing policies, procedures, disaster recovery, business continuity planning, strategic planning. And recently, with the addition of personnel in not only community planning, but police and fire department, we have management who's really excited about implementing technology, and that's going to even require more resources on our end. So that is why I'm requesting. I know hiring a part-time technology person, especially with the skills that I'm looking for, I'm looking with networking service skills. I knew that's going to be a challenge, but I'm hoping I can kind of fit into the same niche when we hired Kate. somebody that wants to stay local, maybe has a family with young kids and is looking to kind of work their way back into the force. I'm hoping and I think we can do it.
So he mentioned phone networks, but I'm not sure that everyone understands that we do run a voice over IP phone network. So every phone in this entire organization runs through the computer servers. We do that at an extreme benefit to the town. I think Steve did a buyback memo a few years ago showing us what 10 years of doing this was. And the town has saved hundreds of thousands of dollars by doing it, but it does require some complexity. And it means that he's 24/7 sometimes. I know I've seen Steve work at 2 o'clock in the morning while he's on vacation in Maine from a cell phone. And so that's really not sustainable. You can't have an organization like that. And so Kate stepped in, and she does a lot of that, but we can even see then that we're, sometimes outstretching our own resources. So this is actually what I would consider a position for the entire town, even though it's within one department. Actually, they're very rarely in their offices. They're usually in someone else's office helping them. So
Stephen, is that part-time, that solve the problem? I mean, were you looking for more than that, but you were okay with the part-time?
I'm sure eventually it may work into a full-time position with, the needs. I mean, the technology needs consistently grow. But I think with this, it would help out immensely with what we're trying to accomplish now.
Well, when you started out, were you looking, best case scenario, getting a full-time person or to fit this immense need? Or
could I make use of a full-time person? Yes. But I think to slowly work into it would be the best option.
Okay.
Good. Yeah. Now, I'd appreciate a copy of the document you were referencing as you were talking about all the work. That would be helpful to have.
Sure.
Do you want to also talk about the other side of it, the expense side, Steve, the GIS? Because that's the other increase.
Another request that I'm looking for is for a GIS consultant. It's $9,360. Works out to approximately 2 hours a week. And over the last several years, GIS has increased quite a bit throughout the departments. We've recently implemented a couple of applications, one for the building department for permitting applications, and people GIS, which is actually across many departments. DPW uses it, town clerk uses it for business licenses, pet registrations, fire department uses it, police department use it. What it does is basically create a database, and it'll visualize on a map. So let's say hydrants, fire department uses it for hydrants. You can enter the hydrant flow rate, different, the last time it was maintained, and then it will show up on a map. A person could click on the map, bring up all that information about the hydrant. DPW is going to be using it for many of the municipal assets, signs, trees, other items. And these two applications talk to each other, and the way that they talk to each other, the key linkage between the two is owner information and addressing information out of the assessor's vision appraisal database, parcel database. And the key to maintaining this data is to maintain consistency across that data, where it links to all the databases. When we were implementing the permitting application, one of the older databases was not entering addressing information, was not validated against anything, so a person manually entered the information in there. So now when we try to bring it into the new database, simple things like drive, like our street is ST instead of STREET, and it doesn't match up. So the GIS consultant will assist in maintaining that data integrity, developing procedures, best practices to maintain that. Plus, they'll also be assisting us with maintaining maps and data, and also assisting some of the departments with in-house data collection of municipal assets. So I think it's key to maintaining the linkage between all the applications. Along with those applications, the database, the addressing is also used in the Munis Financials database, plus the SHREC computer-aided dispatch system.
Questions?
Thank you.
All right, thank you very much.
Great.
So your next budget is the reserve fund, which appears on page 6. I'm sorry,
page 5.
Page 5.
For the reserve fund, we're requesting $550,000. We're level funding it. What the reserve fund is, we in our financial policy, we are to maintain 0.75% of total operating budget. And with this year, it is within the range. So we're level funding it at $550,000.
Your next budget is...
I have a quick question on that. So, and I don't know what the number is in terms of what we have left over. But what does happen if we have a leftover money in the reserve?
In this reserve fund, it goes to fund balance.
Okay.
Historically, we don't have a lot left over. In the last few years, we've used every dime for snow and ice.
Well, I can understand that, yeah. That might answer my other question.
Okay, so your next budget is category group insurance. Workers' compensation and unemployment appears on pages 157 to 161. These are fairly straightforward. I'll let Sue walk you through them.
Group insurance, for right now, we have requested a 10% increase over 16's budget. We will not know until March.
Usually we know, we don't know definitively until actually usually April, end of April, when we're past town meeting. But we have a good sense of what the screening committee, steering committee is going to recommend at a full body for the Mayflower Healthcare Group. And that usually occurs in the March, February, March time period. I serve on the board, and so I at least have a sense as it's building where we are. We have historically maintained 10% of an increase year over year for healthcare. For about the last 10 years, we used to maintain 15%. And, you know, we would regularly hit that. We've had a really good run for the last 5 or 6 years. We're starting to see some healthcare inflation. Last year, we had a rate increase for the first time in, I believe, 4 years. You know, the numbers are portending to another rate increase this year. I don't believe it'll be the full 10%, but at this point in time, prudence would say just leave it be and let's see how it develops. But we're going to be utilizing surpluses here, hopefully, to balance our budget.
I was just going to ask you that. So we've already made transfers out of this account, or was it?
No, that was last year. So you're only allowed to make a transfer out of an existing budget, 3% of the total budget max, and it's only within the last 2 months of the fiscal year.
Okay. So whatever we didn't previously was for the last fiscal
year. Correct. It was in June for last year.
But we had a surplus from last
Correct.
Year.
Correct. Yes. We did.
Are we anticipating another surplus?
This year we are anticipating a surplus.
Yes, we are.
I don't know if you started calculating that. Usually we know that about now. Have you?
No, I have not calculated yet.
So, I mean, usually as we're getting into this process, we'll start looking at those numbers. We actually don't know what this budget is going to look like until Correct. After the school starts and the teachers re-enroll, because that's when a new teacher could be hired mm-hmm. and they're entitled to. It used to be that, you know, that wasn't a big event for us, but healthcare costs about $21,000 for a family plan. So, you know, 5 or 6 employees can swing us pretty far. We'll be able to get you the surplus that we expect for 16, and then we'll obviously look at the budget for 17.
And when will we know the surplus? You said
We can calculate
spring.
It now,
spring,
probably
yeah.
get pretty accurate. No,
no,
the 16 number we'll have shortly, we can provide to you.
Oh.
You won't be available to expend it until the last 2 months of the year.
Right.
The 17 number, the Mayflower Healthcare Group is moving through the rate setting process now. They should conclude that March, April.
Okay.
The next category is other post-employment benefits, or OPEB, requesting $795,063, and this is right off the actuary report that we get done every 2 years.
So why is it going down again?
Actuarial gains.
Okay. So the benefit of, okay, so as the composition of the workforce changes.
Composition of our health care plan.
Yes.
Our health care, the group of people in our health care plan changes.
Right.
And as that group changes, we have actuarial gains and actuarial losses. The investment of our assets, we have actuarial gains and we have actuarial losses. When you see this number going down without any decrease in benefits, which we do not have.
Right.
That means we've had actuarial gains. So I know we had good earnings last year on the OPEB trust fund, and we've had actuarial gains from the composition of the individual in the healthcare plan changing.
We're on like a 30-year funding schedule?
Yes.
So we're, I don't know, is this about year six?
2009 was the first year, okay. So we actually are, this will be year eight for us.
So, I mean, one other thing I would just throw out to my colleagues as we're thinking about potential and, you know, a fund balance is that, you know, we oftentimes look and say, you know, a big capital project or, you know, paying off some of the debt. I would also say that, you know, we should also consider some of these liabilities and, you know, whether it's of interest to accelerate the contribution to post-employment benefits. You know, pros and cons to it, but it should be something that's in the mix.
And that's a good point. I mean, I think we have to balance all those interests, and it's not easy sometimes.
Yeah.
I can tell you that the bond rating agencies are finally looking at OPEB. Every one of their questions now across all rating questions, as I discussed with our financial advisor last week, are where are you in your OPEB? And if it hasn't changed or you haven't done anything with it, what are you doing with your health care plans? So as I told you a number of years ago, this was coming, and it just, for the economic collapse of 2009, I think delayed it. But bond rating agencies are expecting communities to fully fund their OPEB, and if you don't, they're going to start, in my opinion, start lowering bond ratings. We're not in that capacity. We are, our bond rating is AAA, and it'll stay that way, with at least from that perspective.
Okay, the next line item is conservatory retirement. It is requested at $4,029,783. The increase is due to last town meeting, we increased the COLA base from $12,000 to $13,000. And this is right off our actual report, too. Next line item is workers' comp. I am asking for a 10% increase, and Ted has agreed. We have to start funding our fund balance in the workers' comp trust. The past couple of years, we've had some hefty runs at this, so I'm asking for $330,000.
So as you know, we're self-insured for workers' compensation outside of police and fire, where we secure an insurance contract to mitigate our risk. Police and fire personnel have a very particular employment agreement under state law. They have a heart and lung presumption. That means we buy all of those issues, no matter where they occur. And they can be very expensive, and so prudence says, you know, you need to protect your downside risk on that. But we've been experiencing, and it's cyclical. We're self-insured for everybody else, and you know, we've had a number of good years, and then we cycle into some years where people have more injuries, and we have to deal with that. So we have a number of people on workers' comp, you know, last few years that we hadn't had in the past. We use a trust fund so that we can ameliorate some of the swings in that. We put in the same amount every year, and we try to create some surpluses to offset some of the down years. But what we've been seeing here, and that's why Sue's asking for this, is there aren't many surplus years the last few. And so we've drained that fund balance, and we need to start paying those costs and adding to that.
Next budget, unemployment compensation. I'm level funding it at $30,000. We've had no issues the past couple of years, so I think $30,000 will be fine.
I'm usually always asked this at some point in time. If we don't have planned layoffs, why are we having unemployment insurance, unemployment costs? We pay dollar for dollar. This is not unemployment insurance. We're not like private companies that have to pay a percent of payroll to unemployment. We pay dollar for dollar. So if someone collects benefits, we pay it. Even though we're not in a period where we're reducing staff, for a number of reasons, with the 1,700 employees across all departments that we have, people leave. And sometimes they leave our employee, go work somewhere else, leave there, and their unemployment comes back to us. So there's a lot of different reasons why it occurs, and invariably we have unemployment expense even when we're not in a period where we're reducing staff. So.
Next one, employers Medicare, $742,500. This is mandatory Medicare expense for salaries. Okay. We're doing property?
Yes, your last one should be property insurance.
And the last one, general insurance, property and liability insurance. I'm asking for $605,000. It's an increase of 10% from 16. As you know, we've had a lot of claims in the past few years, and this is just to keep up with the cost of the insurance.
One of the reasons our insurance is going up is because we've added about $100 million worth of buildings in the last several years. The middle school, the East Elementary School, and other buildings that we've worked on. Each of those additions, we pay our insurance policies based on the property value of our buildings. So.
I'm done.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right, our next budget is Elder Services. I see Barbara in the audience. Your last appointment of the night. Wants to know what time you're going to be done.
Right.
So.
I can read lips.
All right. So Barbara's budget appears on page 105. And she made my job very easy this year. She didn't ask for anything extra, and so her budget was pretty straightforward. I'll have her explain it to you.
Okay. First, I'd like to introduce Dick Pont and Linda Hurley. They sit on the Council on Aging. Linda's actually recycled back on after about 8 years off, so we're glad to have her back. Budget's pretty straightforward, I think. Salaries are, there's no surprises there. All the staff is intact from before. There's probably the biggest decrease comes in expenses. We went back and again looked at our gasoline usage from last year and the year before, and based on that, and I think we'll probably see a decrease in our contracted costs, we've reduced our gasoline expenses for the upcoming year. And the next major change is moving the tax work off program out of our budget into the assessor's overlay budget. That's allowable by law, and in looking at the tax work off program, we're going to be making some changes over the next fiscal year. Currently, we operate the program on a July through June fiscal year. And beginning in fiscal 17, we're going to look at going on a calendar year. it makes more sense to do that for a couple of reasons. The people who participate in the program are responsible for OBRA, so that comes out, and that's based on a calendar year. And in talking with the departments, summer's really a downtime for a lot of people. There's not a lot of projects, and as we start getting into budget season, town elections, those kinds of things, that's when the real need is there for departments to have that additional support through tax work-off. So we believe that we'll be able to make do better placements that way and probably place more people. And then the last part of that has to do with how you would fund that if you go on a fiscal year, because we'll always be encumbering with people working, and it didn't make any sense to keep the money in our account. It made more sense to bring it over to overlay so that we at least always covered for those encumbrances.
We fund this line item through the meals tax, and we have the funding. So regardless of where it goes, the funding is going to follow it. So it's really sort of just an accounting process, not a budgetary one.
It actually saves some accounting steps because we're sending the money to or the list over to assessors, then up to accounting, and we're doing journal entries, and this way it'll just be one clean entry.
Barbara, it looks like in the past, so I'm just looking at FY15, mm-hmm. that the maximum allowable credit is $1,000 per eligible senior. So that says that in 2015, you had 35 participants. Okay. You know, I know as this program's been getting up and running, we've all been sort of speculating on what's the, you know, what, how many people will take advantage of it. What conclusions have you drawn after doing this for a few years?
I think what happened is we lost several people when we had to go to the reporting IRS W-2s. They don't have to report it as income for the state, but they do for the federal government. And we had some people in there that they were going to lose benefits. I mean, mm-hmm. they were going to lose their mass health, food stamps, those kinds of things. So they dropped out of the program. And I think that $25 coming out was sort of a trigger point.
Yeah.
What we're looking at doing, and you'll be seeing a Warren article come forward, is, and it's kind of a roundabout way to answer your question, is there's been some changes in the law where we can adjust the amount of reimbursement annually up to the minimum wage, and people will then be allowed to work a maximum of 125 hours.
Instead of the 100.
And I think that will encourage more people to enroll, because when we get to $11 at 125 hours, we're up over, you know, $1,200.
So in other words, so there have been, in the past, there were some regulations mm-hmm. that said that if we increased it above $1,000, it was triggering tax events that were actually then detrimental to people participating.
Correct.
So that would mean that the sort of $1,000 would go up to how much?
It will be based on minimum wage.
Yep.
So for next year, because technically minimum wage for $10 doesn't go into effect till January, yep. At 125 hours, they will be able to earn $12.50. And then once we'll, you know, the next year, I think we go to 11, and then it caps out at 12, I think, the following year.
That's great.
So I think that will encourage people actually to participate in the program.
Thank you.
The program is also available to a certain number of people not
under 60.
Under 65.
Yes.
I think 10%.
Right now it's 4 slots. I think.
4 slots.
And
those are hard to fill.
Yeah, as the economy's improved, we've seen those harder to fill. And we do have a surrogate where people can work, and those hours or that tax benefit goes to somebody else. We've not had a lot of people take advantage of that. We've actually had, I think, two in the last, since we enacted that.
Mm. So, Barbara, I just don't want to comment on the numbers as much, but I just want to, again, just thank you and your staff and the board for the phenomenal job you do with the seniors in this town.
And
I really enjoyed when I saw you this week with a full house of seniors. Enjoying I might have missed the caroling with the police department, but let me tell you, everybody was happy to be there. festive occasion, and you do a great job with them.
And the police department does all that, so they do a great job with that every year.
You're right.
My mother-in-law sure enjoys the same Santa, so thank you so much.
I think we saw her there.
Undoubtedly.
At the lunch.
it was funny because I was talking with somebody this week, and you know, it's sort of hard to explain a senior center and what it really means to people. And this individual's been coming for several years, and her husband's recently had some health problems, and but she sort of summed it up. She, you know, she's dropped like 60 pounds in the last 3 years. She's made a lot of new friends. They've formed a book group. And she has the whole support in the community that she didn't have before. And I said, that's it. So, you know, she's gained much better health. She's offered diabetes medication. I was really impressed with that story.
Good story.
I want to just alert you to something that the council's working on this year. One of the things we're looking at as part of our strategic plan is our staffing pattern. I think the way we operate now and the way we're staffed isn't quite what it should be based on the activity that occurs at the senior center and how it's changed over the last 10 to 15 years. So they're going to be doing a real in-depth study on that and looking at current staffing. And as I've said to the staff, you know, it's wide open, throw it out there. What's an ideal staffing pattern? And also looking towards the future, if we were to relocate to a larger senior center facility, what our needs are going to be at that point in time. I just want to alert you to that.
And it's also, I think, worth noting that the number of volunteer hours that are contributed to mm-hmm. the senior center is, it's so significant.
Yeah.
I think when we were all at the volunteer appreciation lunch, you shared some statistics, and I think if we had to pay for all of those hours, this salary budget would probably be twice or three mm-hmm. times the size it is. So we're also very grateful to the hundreds of community volunteer hours,
especially the drivers.
They're great, aren't they? And lastly, if you haven't had a chance, HCAM's just done a great segment on elder services. So,
thank you so much.
Thank you, Barbara.
Thank you for the work you do.
You're up. You guys. Engineering is your next budget. Appears on page 79. Two familiar faces.
I'm quick on my feet.
Gentlemen.
Good evening.
So, gentlemen, Mr. Fernandez,
always good to see you.
Welcome, guys.
Sylvester are here to present their fiscal 17 budget. It appears on page 79, and I can tell you that in summary, we have a little bit of conversation regarding this budget. The department requested $576,825 of base request. They asked for an additional request of $376,950. This wasn't a surprise request. However, given the fiscal constraints, I could only approve recommend to you $1,950, which relates to a very particular item within the department. For a total budget of $578,775, a small increase year over year of $728, and a 0.13% increase.
Was it 3.1?
A 0.13% increase. 0.13.
Okay.
And obviously that's because I'm not recommending the additional personnel and the additional dollars to the road building budget. I have talked with Roger and Harry about presenting to you after the first of the year a warrant article request to look for a greater amount of funding to deal with a number of roads or the road building project in total, an opportunity to look at all the roads, reset somewhat, and look at how we examine them and make sure that we're where we want to be given the utilities that we have to deal with, and see how we can deploy more funds to this, because it was a clear request I heard from each of you and from the community that we need to get to more road funding work. And so we have a plan to do it, but we're certainly not going to be able to do it through the existing operating budget, as you can see the numbers. And we're at a $500,000 deficit. I couldn't add another $375,000 to that and expect to be able to surmount our numbers. But we mentioned earlier that we have fund balance, and previously I had been thinking more along the lines of a longer-term debt authorization to deal with some of these assets that are going to last for 20 to 30 years. But regardless, I'm going to come up with a number of opportunities for you to create some policy about increasing road funding. But that was an overview, and I want you know give Roger an opportunity to talk to you about his base budget.
Well, just to summarize the summary items, there's $241,350 in salaries, $35,475 in engineering expenses. That includes fuel and A&E services, which is architectural engineering services, as they may be necessary. Skipping down to the road building item, it's $284,000 that goes directly towards paving, $1,000 that goes towards the advertising of projects during the procurement process, and an additional $15,000 in the secondary architectural engineering service budget. So, as Ted mentioned, we had, what we do every year is we come to the board and go before advisory, and we let you folks know what we think needs to happen with respect to the infrastructure and what we need to invest to sort of continue improving the infrastructure. And then from that, we sort of start our dialogue in terms of how do we do that and what's available, given all your other all the other needs in the town. We did ask for an additional staff person this year to assist with the work. I think it's and one of the reasons why we did that this year is, in addition to the roads that we reconstruct every year, we do a lot more. We if a roof needs to be replaced on the building, or a boiler needs to be replaced in the library, we manage the procurement, contract writing, the project management associated with that. As a matter of fact, we did a sort of a back of napkin just addition of what some of the stuff that we've managed over the years, over the 5 or 6 years, and it's close to $18 million of work that's totally unrelated to sort of horizontal work. But in talking to Ted, I know that we're talking about some different ways that we can combine all these initiatives plus the work that we're doing today, that again includes a lot more than road work, and how do we get the support that we need staff-wise to be able to take that all on. If it's a grant writing, we handle that as well. Dealing with some of these larger initiatives or grants that might come up, or we do see the money for those things, we manage that work as well. And so we're straight out, to be perfectly candid. So I think discussing this road building funding option, along with all the work that we currently do, is going to provide an opportunity to sort of digest all this and maybe come up with a solution.
Okay. Oh, no, I was just going to let Mary go first if she was.
Thank you. I forgot my question, so I'm going to go back to you. You threw me for a second there, so.
Okay.
And I'll think of it.
All right. So, Roger, I want to thank you. And Harry, one of the things I actually like to see is when you ask for something you think may make a difference in the town, even if we may not have it potentially in the budget. I think the whole issue with the roads, is I know you guys are kind of stretched out awfully thin. I think I've heard it loud and clear from people in town that we need to do something more. I think Ted maybe to mention about some potential things that may happen after the first of the year, but I will just say that I would be inclined to, because it's really, your budget is not really, it's almost level funded. I would be inclined to try to put some money in there. And that one of the questions I have is, we may not get $300,000, but if you did have the $300,000, what are we looking at for roads for the next fiscal year? Are we looking at 10 more roads done, 2 more roads? How does that work?
Well, that's difficult to quantify, only because it depends on the type of work that we're doing on those particular roads. As we've talked about in the past regarding the costs associated with doing those roads, reconstruct versus sort of a maintenance approach. I think, you know, it can add substantially. We're not going to get 30 roads done with $300,000. But if it's general terms, I would say, you know, we could, for $50,000 or $60,000, we can level and micro-surface a road that needs a low amount of sort of maintenance, if you will. And if it's a full-depth project, that could more than go up six times, you know, that value. So it really depends on which roads we attack.
So that's one of the reasons why Roger and I didn't have enough time, well, I didn't actually, with the budget and all that I had in front of me and closing out the end of the year to come up with a realistic approach for how much money we could deploy. I'm thinking of a figure that's substantially larger than what you see here in the budget, because I heard the requests from each of you and all the people that came here. You're not, $300,000 is not going to solve that issue. $300,000 is probably going to exacerbate some of your problems, because you'll do one or two roads maybe, and there'll be 10 or 15 other people wondering why you aren't doing those. So I think what we're trying to do is talk about how we can bootstrap up quite a larger amount of money and a person to be able to help Roger manage that through a larger sum of money outside of the budget process. Something that also, one of the problems with it in the budget is, as Roger's talked to you about, the year cutoffs are odd for him. So having it in the form of an article that he could draw down periodically without constraint of fiscal years would give them a lot of flexibility.
Ted, how would we fund the article?
So the two ways to fund it would be to use existing revenues, to use existing fund balance or debt. Those would be the three areas.
But when will we decide that, if we were going to go on that route?
My proposal is to present you with something before January 20th, so you can include it on the warrant for this annual town meeting, so it's part of the budget process. The budget will go to town meeting in April. We'll spend it in July. I'm going to propose a fairly large expansion of the road building program.
Well, and it's encouraging to hear, and obviously I think we've all heard the folks in town, and my inclination would be to support something, whether it be an increase or you know, coinciding with some other proposal that might come up. I just think we need to step it up for the town, and I think we, you know, you guys are obviously thinking outside the box and trying to come up with some ideas. We appreciate that.
Thank you. Just to expand on your question regarding how many more roads we could do. I mean, all the connector roads and commuter roads in town are in pretty decent shape. Any additional money would probably be on the neighborhood local roads. And a lot of those would probably be repaving projects. Especially if the money came in late, we'll be adding roads to the road construction list that's already in place. You know, any full-depth reconstruction roads would probably be a year or two down the road to put them on the five-year plan.
Okay. Roger, how much do you think we're going to get with it's Chapter 90?
We're forecasting about $750,000, unless the governor does what he did last year, which infused an additional $300,000 into the Chapter 90 program, released the money.
And $1.1 million has been sort of the annual target for kind of keeping things where they are. I would first of all thank you both for the great work that you do. In addition to, you know, these other projects, you know, you're going to be involved in two really important projects, the Route 3A, you know, that corridor, and then the Derby Street corridor. And I know that that a lot of the groups, the Harbor Development Committee, the trustees of the Bathing Beach, that you've been providing them with a lot of great guidance as they move forward with their projects as well. So I'm aware of the different constraints on your time. You're very generous with your time, and we seek your help on a lot of different things, so I understand that. I would agree with what Paul said about the roads. I think we've, you know, for a long time as a town, we weren't keeping up with, for a lot of different reasons. And I think what's happened is, now that as people are starting to see, you know, you drive through Crow Point, And I mean, it was kind of a disaster a couple of years ago. And now when you drive through and see these beautiful roads, I think the frustration for people whose roads are deteriorating only gets a little bit higher. So in some ways, we're a little bit of a victim of our success. I would also say that when this program started a few years ago, I think you were pretty upfront with the Selectmen and the Advisory Committee about choices on spending the dollars. And I think collectively, the Advisory Committee, the Selectmen, with your guidance, we made choices. And some of our choices were to devote a substantial amount of money to the roads before they got to that failure. Mm-hmm. I think we're at a point now where we've reduced our liability tremendously, but it was from like $24 million to $15 million. I can appreciate that if you've got a failing road and you know you're looking at it's frustrating. Mm-hmm. So I will look forward to you and Ted coming back with a proposal for how we might do that. I know that in the past we've talked about the potential for a lot of disruption, and would that be unpleasant for people? Mm-hmm. I think because as Harry said, a lot of this are neighborhood streets. I think what I'm kind of hearing from people is we can make do with a little bit of inconvenience if that means we can move a little bit faster.
Mm-hmm. Well, I appreciate that. I think it should be noted as well in terms of what we've done and where we've come since the original sort of presentation regarding the road building plan. Is we're at a point where about one out of every three roads in the town of Hingham have been reconstructed in some fashion. So you know we feel pretty good about that. Is that good enough? No, but I think one out of three, given the time that we've had, we're ahead of schedule in terms of what we projected. I would also say, as you begin to look through your financial plan, you talk about the debt and what Ted's representing, this much I can assure you that the cost of reconstructing the road is outpacing your debt that you would incur to do the work. So that's something to consider. Now, you have other things to consider along with that, but it's certainly outpacing that. And an infusion of money would not be a permanent one either, to Ted's point. It would put us in a position where we've sort of addressed everything, and then after that, we really do fall into a sort of maintain it as we go program. It's just getting to that point. We're one third of the way there, but we won't need that total amount of money for the duration of the infrastructure's life cycle. So these are all things to consider.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Gentlemen, good evening.
Good evening.
Would I understand it correctly that if the existing model would remain operative, it would simply be energized by the infusion of additional funds? Is that your scheme or your plan or concept to maintain the roadways either through partial, full depth, or microseal? That would remain operative, right?
Well, the approach in terms of what we do, in terms of types of construction would, but I think one thing we're going to look at is just reevaluating where we are, what roads are on the list.
Remember,
try to get a sense of where we've...
One of the reasons, Rod, when they select roads and how they do it, it's also based on how much money they have. So you asked that question earlier, and Harry said, well, if it's this road, or Roger, if it's this road, it's this much, if it's this, it's that much. So when you're fitting these pieces in the puzzle and you know how much money you have in a given year, sometimes you drop something because you just didn't have the money to get to it. You had two-thirds of it. So we're going to look at that, and we're going to see how we can move through that, see what work both these guys have been able to do with the utilities, which has been fabulous, and getting them to not mess up our roads after we fix them. That's probably the most important thing they do.
I'm sorry to interrupt. If you are accelerating the work going on, is National Grid going to be able to keep up with this if you have to do replacement gas mains and lines?
National Grid's been pretty cooperative, but it may take a year or two. Let's say, for example, Smith Road, we're going to accelerate that on a construction schedule, and that road has to have a gas main replaced. I know it just got replaced with Smith Road, just an example now.
Sure.
It might take a year for them to get in there, or maybe two at the outside. Depends how many extra roads we're adding on to their schedule, because they're driven by the DEP telling them that they have X, Y, and Z in every town they have to replace. And if we give them A, B, and C plus X, Y, and Z, I mean, of course, they have to operate by a budget as well. and they can only add so many roads to the construction.
I think he just gave you the reason why this is not an easiest, this is not just so easy as take some money and throw them on a couple roads and say, let's do these.
Well, that's what I'm getting at.
We're going to have to see how far can we push natural gas, the gas company, the water company. I think the other utilities more.
Well, that's not just, I mean, we overlook our own DPW because they have to go and do a lot of prep work on these roads. And you know, they're stretched out with this general maintenance. Then once we give them, say, you know, 8 or 10 streets to go ahead in a year in advance, go in and upgrade the drainage infrastructure. I mean, that's also a stress on the department. So there's a lot of factors you have to look at. We're working on a short-term construction schedule.
Yeah.
Last year with the winter, you know, sliding into May as far as construction goes, try to hit the road running as fast as you can. And we want to, under the best case scenario, finish by no later than middle of September. You don't want to be out there doing road construction when school's in place, when temperatures dropping overnight. I mean, I see, you know, towns around us doing road construction into December.
Right.
The product isn't anywhere near as good as you're going to get if you do it in the summer months, and that's what our target is. So, I mean, you mentioned the inconvenience of some of the residents. If we can get the contractors that are on the contract to stay in town to do the volume of work we're going to have slated, we could have 4 or 5 different areas of town that could be tied up, and it does get frustrating. But, I mean, we do a pretty good job at of scheduling work, one contract from another coming and doing construction work and setting up pretty good detour routes, but there is a level of inconvenience with the volume of work you have coming, you know, going on at one time.
And none of this road work, this anticipated road work, would be done on private ways, right?
Nothing that we have scheduled, no.
Town doesn't do work on private ways. It's strictly
absolutely
public
not.
Ways.
Yeah. We do have residents on private ways calling us, asking, what can we do with our road? Meaning, what can they do with their road?
And we help.
And we give them, you know, the best advice we can, make recommendations to certain contractors, you know, that they might want to.
Does that typically require them to bring that roadway up to spec per the planning board regulations, or do you do an assessment?
They may ask me about, you know, could we get this road accepted by the town. I said, you have to go to the planning board and look under the subdivision control law and then bring it up to those standards, and to hold them in process, probably a lot more costs than they would be willing to bear.
I think one of the challenges are, you know, for the private roads anyway, is maintaining them at a level that the DPW can approve the snow plowing on them, because, you know, that's a requirement.
So. Yeah, but I think to your question, Paul, it's so when you infuse additional money into the program, I wish we could adequately sort of explain the coordination that's required just to get the 1.15 or 1.3 done now in 5 or 6 months, you know, line up the con. And by the way, you know, there's this misconception that the contractors are there just sitting, waiting for us to call them. No, there are, you know, other communities, other private projects, so that coordination needs to happen in a certain way, and the gas company is certainly one of those things. The good news is that based on what we've done with them in the past 5 or 6 years, they're no longer just one step ahead of us. In most cases, they're 2 steps ahead of us in terms of getting their work done, so we're not literally, and that was the case in prior years where we would literally be there, you know, you guys going to be done by this day, you got to get done, we're going to be there in 3 weeks, you got to be out of there. So it's gotten a little better, but when we add more work, sure, that's going to choke them a little bit, and so we've got to coordinate all that. Yeah.
And you know, that may also speak to the benefits of sort of a multi-year approach in this.
Right.
Is that may provide some flexibility in a lot of different ways and allow this to ramp up a little bit.
Yeah.
I would also imagine that as a community, if you know, town meeting approves a warrant article for these sorts of funds, I would think that would make us a community of choice for private contractors and things. They know the money's here, the commitment's here. I would hope that would count for something.
It does. I mean, the one thing that we pride ourselves on is, as Harry stated, is there's a benefit in terms of certain efficiency and expediency doing the work, but there's also one in terms of what we pay. So if you have the work properly lined out, the contract is coming in, there's a larger volume of work that's done. By extension, he's making what he needs in terms of profit, which is fine. You know, we get our work done. As a matter of fact, the work that we bid out, for example, I know that we're getting more aggressive pricing than some of our other communities that might even be in a consortium, and the reason why is that, as Harry stated, we've got a couple of days worth of work consecutively so that they're in and they know they're going to get the volumes they need. So all that stuff comes into play, you know, all that stuff matters. Yeah.
One last thing. I just want to make sure, and people at home, I'm sure that heard it, appreciate it, and are encouraged by it, that you're, it's an ongoing process. You're going to reevaluate and look at what we have for resources and what we have for needs out there, and that's, that'll go a long way.
Thank you. You certainly will. Yeah.
You see the, any night work here?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, there's always night work.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just warming up the public for that reality.
You know, there's a bunch of talk. The industry is going more towards night work, is it, you know, in general, on whether it's paving, resurfacing. I mean, much of it's going to start going night work. And we try to inform the public. I mean, we just did a few, we did four crosswalks in the square. We didn't get some notices out to certain people. And we got complaints from them. But in general, the public's been very, you know, acceptive of the night work.
And that ties into staffing, you know. If I'm here three nights a week, and he's working out there, you know, a couple of nights a week, and then we have all these other things that are even beyond infrastructure work. If the roof's getting replaced, if something else is happening, typically our offices and, you know, all the other town offices come to us in terms of procurement. There's nobody in the town of Hingham that procures more for the town than the engineering office does. Maybe larger projects like the school, but individual, and those things take time. So I think that one of the things that we need, I really want to walk away with you all understanding is, you know, putting $500,000 into a program just means that Harry, myself, and a part-time worker in our office has to manage an additional $500,000 worth of work. And so
I would just, to allay any concern you have, you know, we ask people for, you know, a level services budget, which is kind of, you know, doing what you're doing now, what would it cost next year? What we're talking about here with respect to the road work is an expansion of services. And I think, you know, to a degree, that it would say that the existing staffing can't support it. So if we want to do this, there has got to be a staffing component. It's, you know, you can't separate those two. It would, you know, it's like if, you know, if we had 150 kids into a school, you need some new teachers, you need some new things. It's the same thing with this.
So the component of financing that I'm giving you will include a labor component along with an expenditure component. We're not going to be able to add more road work without adding a labor component to it. So I'm going to try to, that's what, and I'm looking for some economies of scale too, because again, you know, you don't want to just do one more road and hire a person. So I think we're going to want to try to do a little bit more work, or substantial more work, and add the labor to that.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Merry Christmas. Good night.
You will see me before Christmas.
I can't believe we're saying that.
All right, your next budget is a combination of veteran celebrations and GR Hall.
I said, oh, well, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you, though.
I'm just saying, it seems it's, I can't believe it's already that time of year. Oh, no, it's not that.
So the veterans budget appears on page 112 in your budget books. From a summary standpoint, the budget is, the budget request for this year was $360,474. There were no additional requests. It is actually, I've recommended the entire budget. It's a reduction year over year of $19,595, a 5.16% reduction. And before you get excited about us reducing benefits in this area, I'd ask Keith to explain to you the budget.
Good evening.
Thank you, Keith.
As you know, I'll hit it line by line, the salaries, expenses, and benefits. Salaries, overall increases, just your normal step increases, that's can be found on page 113, that's the schedule. The expenses, which is technically all that the Department of Veteran Services can control. So that's your, what we call beans, bullets, and Band-Aids, right? That's your paper clips, pens, and et cetera. Wreaths and flowers and things that I can control, and some things I can't control, postage, an increase or a decrease, as it may be in this year, of actual postage, due in part and parcel to the fact that a lot of the VA systems, and which is federal systems, and the state systems are going online. So that's a good thing. That'll decrease our postage in that area. Benefits is the wild card in this. In accordance with Mass General Law Chapter 115, we're responsible if a veteran and or dependent qualifies for the program. We're responsible for them with two different things. One would be ordinary benefits, which also takes into account some fuel relief and the medical or the medical portion of it. So just to walk you through that real quick, the ordinary allowances this particular year moving forward reflected a decline in the Chapter 115 population due to relocation, transition to nursing homes of an aging population, and an overall attrition rate or a death rate in those veterans that are of the World War II and career, especially at about a rate nationally of 1,800 a day. So just now beginning to see those from the Vietnam era are retiring and are seeking benefits. They're coming in, they're figuring out that it's time, that they need, that they're going to be on a fixed income maybe, and they're going to have to bridge that gap. So they're eligible, they've earned those benefits, and we're responsible to produce them. As Ted mentioned, the overall budget is approximately a 5.2% decrease, and that's with an increase that I know about in a group policy that we have in the upwards of 15%. And prescription drug coverage, which has really gone through the roof at about 22%. So even with those known factors, we've still managed to have that reduction. So the hospital component, what we call a hospital component, is usually set aside. That remains steady. And that's just a catch-all, if you will, in case we have an ambulance ride or two that isn't covered. That we're not counting on, and those, as you know, are roughly $1,000 or so each time. So we built that in as well. Do you have any questions on
Keith? These costs, the state, this is our share.
Correct. So
the state pays.
No, this is 100%.
This is 100%.
The state reimburses us 75% of what
we spend.
Reimburses
us at a rate of 75%.
So are these net numbers or gross numbers?
That's gross.
Okay. Yeah. Where does the reimbursement?
Comes on the cherry sheet through state aid. It appears in our revenue for state aid.
So I'm glad you mentioned that. This year in particular, the Massachusetts Department of Veterans Services through Secretary Arena has passed in the last legislative cycle, Valor Act 2, which calls for the certification of all veteran service officers with a three-year term and a three-year certification. So for those cities and towns, there's 351 municipalities in the Commonwealth. Yeah, some of them are in our district. There's upwards of about 250 VSOs that are scattered throughout the Commonwealth. If they did not certify or failed to certify on this cycle, that cherry sheet that Ted's talking about, instead of a 75% reimbursement, you would then see a 50%. And for those cities and towns, believe it or not, there are a few that just fail to participate at all in Chapter 115. See, because of this legislation, a 115% tax or levy on there. So if I'm from Community A and you don't have a VSO and you say we don't need a VSO, and I go into to Boston and seek my benefits and they're paid to me, let's use that $1,000 ambulance ride, they would then charge 115% to that city or town for failure to comply with the law.
We are not in that issue at all. Correct. Keith received a certification last week, so we're good to go.
So we're all certified down there, as well as the Cohasset component and our administration staff.
Did you talk about Cohasset at all?
Not yet, no.
Want to cover that?
If you'd like. So currently, as you know, we were involved in an intermunicipal agreement with Cohasset over the last few years. Their veteran service officer is part-time. It's based on population. For those cities and towns that have over 12,000 inhabitants, a full-time agent is required. And there's a schedule, if you will, on going up per population, what you need as far as administrative help. It's just a schedule worksheet. But for those under 12,000, only a part-time agent, or they must district. So our neighboring community of Cohasset decided at first, when they were getting up and running, that they needed to district with us. We were able to partner up with them, provide administrative support, and that too is reimbursed to the town. For instance, if the benefits administrator, Ms. Potts, works 5 hours this week for Cohasset, that is returned usually quarterly by them. We send it, she's paid through our payment process here, and then that's reimbursed to that fund on that line item for expenses that are incurred. This year, as Ted mentioned, he was certified, so we had a long discussion about what we thought moving forward would look like. We talked about maybe districting with some other towns to bring a little bit more bang for the buck. They all too have been certified and are comfortable in their current position, so for the next 3 years it looks like we're going to just return to where we were and just be Hingham, and Cohasset will now, you know, has we can take the training wheels off. They're ready to go. He's up and running. So another job well done. We seem to have a niche for doing that. As you know, several years ago we did the same type of structure with Scituate. So we managed to increase their stakeholders.
Thank you.
I do expect as time goes on that surrounding towns will come back and utilize our services as they have personnel changes. I think that's just going to be the pattern that we'll see given the performance of that office, our office. But right now, we're steady.
Yep. So I'd also like to mention, as you mentioned, Mary, that due to a large number of volunteer hours by our local veterans, this helps defray real costs that I see down in my office. Those real costs are in the form of labor, transportation especially, as we heard from Barbara, that's gasoline and such, and goods. So a lot of veterans down there, a lot of dependents that seem to fill in when we need them and do the right thing, and it's great to see. It's an outpouring of support that these numbers would probably be a lot different. I could tell you that.
That is incredibly key, and I know Keith thanks them and sends them letters regularly, but his job is no longer I think what a traditional VSO was, where they sat in the office and they, you know, people came in, they saw him, he filled out forms, he helped them get benefits. He's frequently on the road in a veteran's home or hospital or some other place dealing with a crisis. They're usually not very nice crises, to be honest with you.
They're usually at night.
And they're usually at night, very late at night, and they provide a lot of stress. But it keeps that office unoccupied, and so people come in and the door is closed if these people that Keith uses don't come in and help man the office. They not only provide the benefit of manning the office, they actually provide another great benefit, which is they tend to be more approachable from some of the clients that you have.
Yeah, it's definitely a sense of comradeship there. They can exchange stories and or things. It's that bond that initiate that first bond of trust that usually the people that are coming through that door, Chapter 115 Mass General Law is based on veterans that are receiving support, as I mentioned, financial and medical, due to a gap or a lack of their income. So these are people that are already have to come through the door needing something, and usually it's usually with a push from someone else, or it's very hard to get them to accept that they need that help.
Having the familiar faces of the veterans that occupy his office is very helpful. So thank them. Anything else?
So roll into celebrations.
Sure.
That's on the workbook.
That's page 133. And I don't think I need to give you any overviews. These next two budgets are pretty straightforward.
Yes, pretty straight. The overall increase really is about 6% or so.
The first line in this budget is not part of Keith's, but it's
right.
Included in this budget.
Right. The 4th of July is not managed by Veteran Services. That's used as contingency operational funding through police and fire. So that's to support or shore up anything during the 4th of July. That's built in. I noticed that is stayed the same for next year. We have had slight increases on Memorial Day due to a need of flags. Due to really a need of legislation and laws that have been passed, which tells us that we have to place a flag at every veteran's grave in the town. There's 6 private cemeteries. We just procured our flags for this Memorial Day, and that's at a tune of about 17 gross. So each one of those graves have to be flagged per law, And the Veterans Day, we saw a slight increase as well due to another law which was passed, which says that all markers now must be metal, not plastic. So we're in the process of replacing all plastic markers throughout the six cemeteries, again, with a huge volunteer base that would be just next impossible if that was just me.
All right, and the next budget is on page 46, the Grand Army Hall.
So Grand Army Hall, again, pretty straightforward. It's one of the town treasures. I think it's a gem of a building built in 1888. We're looking at about a 5.5% increase, which is about $1,800 real dollars. Increase due to usually the utilities, which can be found on page 47, which is the next page. That's the worksheet price index. We use that price index sheet, and we used the FY15 actual volume. We saw a larger uptick in oil and electric. In both of those things, we see an average increase every year for the telephone, which isn't on that worksheet, but again, kind of a utility. It's an older building that we've taken pride in keeping up, and we invite different departments, different committees. For instance, I see my liaison here from ADCOM, and Dave Anderson is in the audience. Recently, while we were going over these numbers and things, and what we would expect when we meet with him in the near future, we always extend that invitation for any board or any committee in the town to utilize that building and come over, and several have. I know Andrea and Historical, they've been over there, ADCOM and schools. A lot of people have used it, so we welcome that. It's widely used. We did see a loss of a great program that we had, and due to no fault of our own, but a failure up on their level, was the Veterans Upward Bound out of UMass Boston. And that's a group that supports usually veterans that are struggling or homeless to find post-secondary education. And we were a satellite campus for that. And we had a great turnout. We had six students there graduate and move on to a 2 and 4 year college. That was a pretty significant role we played there. And we had, again, some volunteers who were able to put together some money, get Verizon over there and have Wi-Fi, so the students had their laptops out, and it was a great thing. But the program had a failure on their upper management level, with the director had retired, an interim director didn't really work out. There was a glitch in the system. So, matter of fact, tonight we have one of our volunteers, a veteran over there, who's presenting a scholarship. We present one every fall and every spring semester to a veteran, usually a homeless veteran. They receive a small monetary scholarship and a certificate of appreciation that we call the Richard Dick Sweeney Award. He was a graduate of that program over at UMass. He was both a member of the VFW and American Legion, which helped to sponsor that program. So we're still actively involved in them, although we don't have the campus anymore.
I would just add that I've had the privilege of representing the board at two Eagle Scout Courts of Honor at GAR Hall, and it's just such a nice thing to open that up, and it introduces GAR Hall to some students who, you know, might not otherwise see it until their sophomore year in high school. So I know the Scout organization is very grateful for that.
Right, and one of our, just to dovetail on that, Mary, on the one of the line items on the GAR Hall budget is other support, and that's that money is earmarked for in the spring and April time frame. We invite the Hingham High School sophomore class has a history day, and they actually, the students and teachers, walk up to GAR Hall, so cost-free. I know Principal McGann and Superintendent Gallo love that. It's a cost-free field trip, and again, it exposes a whole group of individual students that normally wouldn't have access to that may not be in the Scouts or taking part of that program or don't have a father or mother who's a veteran, and they've been in the hall before. So every 10th grade class for the last 7 years has been introduced to that wonderful spot. Thank you.
Thanks
for your work. Welcome home.
Thank you.
All right, your next budget, as you're winding down, is town clerk. The town clerk budget appears on page 23. And
Thanks.
I can give it to you in summary form. The town clerk requested a fiscal 2017 budget of $189,920 with an additional request of $71,911. I've recommended the original request of $189,920. I have not funded the additional request, which was not recommending you to fund the additional request, which is for the archivist and salaries related to it. Overall, the budget will decrease by $333 for the year, a 0.18% decrease year over year. And I'll let Eileen explain her budget to you.
I would like to speak to the archivist position, but first I'll go over my budget, which is very simple because there have really been no changes except for salaries. From year to year, we seem to be able to handle that same budget, and we'll continue that. And when it comes to the archivist, I originally was not going to speak about it. Ted encouraged us, if we felt as though we needed to speak on any subject, to please do. So here I am, Ted.
This is your time.
Yes.
Fire away.
As you know, we did come and speak to you a few weeks, maybe it was a couple of months ago, mm-hmm. about the archivist and everything that she's done for us this past few years. This is the last year for funding for through the CPC. And we haven't finished the project that we were planning on finishing. And we also have more than just what we had set forth in the plans. There is a master plan that we would like to continue with, and I would respectfully ask you to see if we could add that back into my budget.
Sure. Eileen, I stepped out for a second and I came back. I did hear you talk about it, but where is it on the request? Is it?
So it appears on page 23, and yep. If you look at pages 25, actually just page 25, Eileen details the request.
Oh, so it
which
is
includes
the
a salary and an expense component.
I saw the number. I wasn't making sure.
I'm sorry. I probably should have mentioned that. It's $56,911 for salary, and then $15,000 for supplies.
Okay. And I do remember the presentation, and I know that the value that it's given to not only the office but also the town. And I know you have a plan that you'd like to see finished, so to speak. I mean, I certainly. We're early in the process, but I am certainly it's on a list of things that I'm certainly willing to consider. I just want to let you know that.
I would appreciate that.
Yeah, I'm glad that we had the benefit of that presentation back in October, because I think we had the opportunity to spend a lot of time understanding the accomplishments that have taken place, as well as the aspirations to continue. And I think, like Paul, I think we're in the process of kind of hearing all the budgets. I don't think that we will be able to say yes to all the cumulative requests that we have. And I wish we could say yes to all of them, because they're all very worthy requests, and each one on its own is a modest request. But as we look at our forecast, we are going to have to make some choices. And I think, like my colleague was saying, I look at all the different things. I look at all of the different possibilities. So my goal, as we talked about this in the fall, was to make sure that this position was given the same consideration as every other request in the process, and that's going to happen. That will happen. At the end of the day, we will need to say no to some of them.
Yeah, I don't usually debate my recommendations with you. I'm not here to do that. Yeah. But I did want to say, because this is a new position that was asked for, that I'll concur with Eileen and everything I've heard already. This is a worthy position. It's a work we did. It's a shame that I'm recommending to pull back. But I think at the end of the day, you're going to find that you just don't have enough resources to go around, and this is something we could pull back from and pick up again. It's not like we're going to lose our history. But we have a lot of history that's pretty valuable, and some of it, you know, if we don't get to this within a reasonable amount of time, you could lose some of it too. So there's a pressingness to this. You're just going to have to make some choices.
It's also difficult, and I realize that the source of funding is CPC, but when something stops, it often makes it more challenging to pick it back up.
You'd like to be able to continue the momentum.
And I was just going to say the same thing. I mean, it's not always easy once it stops. So.
I guess my comment is, when I was reading the water company decision, and I was reading about how you testified as to the history of the water company, its progression, I saw the value of history applied to present-day circumstances. But I live in an old house, so I don't need to be sold on history. I love history, and especially the history of this town. Although I say it a little differently than my colleagues, we can't say yes to everyone, and I'm trying to figure out if there's a solution here, whether there's another funding source available. I think that should be explored. Whether or not this is something that can be reposited in another department, I'm not sure. So I'm thinking that through.
I do understand all that. And we have talked about funding, if there is some funding that we could get. Most of the time, Jen is the person that is our archivist now. She has told me that you don't get personnel through funding. You usually just get items. Mm. So the personnel is the most important part of it. We can have all the boxes we want, but that being able to put it in the right spot is what we need.
Well said.
I don't know whether anybody...
Do you wish to be recognized, Mr. Hersey?
Yes, I do.
Would you step up to the microphone, please, and identify yourself by name and address?
My name is John Hersey. I've lived in this town 67 years now. I live at 67 Hersey Street. I guess the bottom line is, when do we go in the vault, in the cellar? When do we go in the attic? And when do we go to the library and get everything all organized? That's number one. Number two, I was at a meeting this week with the historical, and there's a woman there. She's a school teacher. And I asked the question. I says, in schools, do we teach history? And, oh, yes. Oh, I do in my class. So it make it a lot easier for these school teachers to come. Can I have this? Yeah, it's right over here. So when do we get this all out that we can pick up a sheet and say, oh, that item is right here, that item is right here. It's been down there 100 years. This stuff has been there 100 years or more.
Well, that's what we're working on.
Yeah, and the more people that go down there and handle it, the more wrecked it might get. I'm sure it does, fingerprints, everything else. It's deteriorating more.
The rocking chair of John F. Kennedy was stored at the GSA building before it ended up at the Kennedy Library. I mean, We'll get this figured out.
I hope you will.
We plan to.
I hope you'll keep this young lady. I think she's done a job for the town. I think your tax base should know that.
It's the position and the role that we're seeking to address. The individual is fine.
Sounds like it's the money. I'm not saying anything negative about the... I think it's the money. I think you should find the money somewhere.
Thank you.
Your opinion is duly noted.
Thank you, John.
Give me another hand in the back.
Do you want to sit here?
Oh, okay. Thank you. I'm Andrea Young, the administrator for the Historical and Historic Districts Commissions. And I've had the benefit of having Jennifer work in my office for the last couple of months. And it's incredible to me that she has been able to organize a lot of material that had been stored in the attic. A lot of it came from boxes that I inherited from Alec McMillan, and Jennifer was able to go through that and to cull out those things that were particularly important to events that have occurred over time. I mean, I'm talking about, you know, the very beginnings of the historic districts, how decisions were made, also things like, I really had no idea that at one point there was a casino proposed for the town of Hingham. And so all that material is there too, as well as the material that original tapes that were recorded in preparation to write the Not All Is Changed history of Hingham. And I guess I just want to say that I think the position, I really appreciate, you know, the whole money factor and looking, trying to balance everything. I just really wanted to speak in favor of this function because I think I have seen some things, well, in Eileen's office, lists of goods from the 1600s. And as you go through each of these books, that are some are bound in, most of them are cloth, and they're bound in, you know, with thread, and they're falling apart essentially. But nevertheless, what's fascinating is that you turn a page, and you know, it is a chronicle of what took place. Who was who sold what to whom. Why it was done, how much it cost, and it's just fascinating to look at. And part of this project involves making this information available for people to do research so that, you know, the ultimate goal is to digitize everything. And so I'm sorry I'm running on, but I'm
you
waxing.
Have ran to regular.
I know.
Thank
get
you.
Off. Give me the hook.
I'm kind of anticipated. I see you up here.
I know. So anyway, I just want to say it's the benefits are you can't put your hands on them. You know, you can't dollars and cents them. It's just they're all intangible, but they're there. You know, it's our history, and we're lucky to have such a history here in this town. So thank you for listening to me. I appreciate it.
Thank you for
appreciate
speaking.
Your consideration.
Have you found any papers on Governor Andrew?
Yes.
Yeah.
Should I?
sorry, Ted.
The library has some of his letters. There isn't a ton, but you'll find pamphlets of his speeches. I've seen, if you go actually on the library website, you can see some, I believe it's his signature, because there's a letter, you know, so there's lots of different ways to find that. So since I'm up here, I would be allowed to, if no one would mind my speaking a little bit.
Just identify yourself for the
record,
please.
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Jennifer Williams. I am the town archivist. I've been here for 3 years now. Wow, it's fantastic. And so I wanted to thank Eileen and the task force for everything that they've done for this fabulous project. And just to speak to a couple of things that I was hoping to introduce concepts that maybe hadn't been spoken about yet. Things like when we're talking about urgency, when we're talking about losing things, I'm thinking digital. Things, we're losing digital things all the time. And that's something that is not necessarily old. Well, obviously it's not this not old if it's digital, but something that we don't think about today that could be gone 5 years from now. People like I remember using WordStar documents and things like that. You cannot open those anymore. They're gone unless you have very sophisticated programs that can retrieve them. So these are things that are urgent. Eileen has things in her office, Andrea was just talking about them, that are absolutely urgent. They will probably not exist 10 to 20 years from now because they're deteriorating so much from the 1600s, from the 1700s. And some of this is legal. You know, there are legal things saying that, you know, that there's a records management unit for the state that says you must keep this. You have to have this. It has to be accessible. So part of this is records management, not just you know, the history that is saying that's helping these departments to say, okay, I have to keep this. I don't have to keep this. Do I want to keep it? If I don't want to keep it, what do I have to do legally to be able to get rid of this? And there are procedures that you have to go through that this position, regardless of who is in it, that person could help, could get rid of some of these space issues that are, the town is dealing with. So just other things that I think, you know, regardless of who's in it, regardless of, you know, other things that would be useful, aside from, you know, and I'm not downplaying at all the history fact, the history part of it, because obviously I love history. So just some other things that I thought you might want to think about or might not know yet. So
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. I think that's the town clerk's budget.
All right. Okay. Now we have elections.
Oh, that's right. Oh, we have to have elections. I forgot about that. All right.
That's why I'm still sitting
here. Are we going to have them this year?
Yeah, well, yeah.
All right. Every year, whether you want them or not.
Yes.
What page are we on?
26.
And this is an exciting year.
It is an exciting year for many reasons.
Eileen and I requested a department request of $20,850. Of salaries and $19,845 of expenses for a $40,695 budget. Fairly substantial increase over last year at $26,945. I've recommended the entire increases, and I think Eileen can walk you through why.
I have a few reasons why I need more money. Mm-hmm. Compared to last year, fiscal 16, we had two elections this year, in this fiscal year, the presidential primary and the town election. Next year we will have three elections. We will have the state primary, the presidential election, and then the town election. Sometimes it's tough trying to figure out what year I'm in. And we also, because of legislation that happened, came to about last June, we also have to have early voting for the November elections, the state elections. Early voting is 11 days prior to the that election. We have to have allow people to come in and vote. Because of that, I will need to have more help, because I don't think that my office would be able to handle that. I think with the early voting, I would imagine that there'll be a lot of people, but this year will be an experiment and to figure out how it's all going to work. So it would be from October 24th to November 5th, which is the Friday prior to the election. And what I am planning to, what we are told to do, there's a difference between what I planned to do and what we're told to do. The elections, they allowed us to, they're telling us that we have to do it within the hours of the work week. So we would have it the same as the work week, 8:30 to 4:30, except on Tuesdays and Fridays. But they also asked us to try to do additional hours. What I would like to do is probably do additional hours in the mornings, because that it, when at the polling places we usually have more people come in at the very first thing in the morning. So if we had it started 7 in the morning, say 7 in the morning until 4:30 in the afternoon, or 7 to 7 on a Tuesday. We also have to have a machine available for us to be able to tally this. It's a separate machine to tally these votes on election day, and that's something else that I'll be doing later on with the capital outlay. I'm planning on getting new machines, and there's a list of what we have to do. Early voting is not the same as absentee ballot. Absentee ballots will still be available, but early voting is a whole separate deal, and like I say, it's a new thing for all of us. So so that's why I'm asking for a larger amount of money than I normally would with the difference between two elections and three elections.
So, quick question. The budget request is for 17, right?
Correct.
So that'll kick in July?
Yes.
Is there room?
So that's the September
November and next year's town election.
Is it maybe a special election?
Yes, we know that.
In March. I don't know. Heard
yes.
That.
That could be a reserve fund transfer if we
that,
can't make it up within the existing budget.
They are saying that there'll be a primary and a state election with that. They're talking about having that with the presidential primary, hopefully. It depends on how things work out. And then I don't know whether it would be close enough to our town election to also combine it with our town election, because we did do that a few years back. We had, I'm sorry, I don't remember which election it was, but it was to fill another position similar to this. And we did combine it with the state election.
Is that April 30th? Is that town meeting, or is that the election?
The election will be, I think it is April 30th.
April 30th.
Town yes.
Because I, depending when they call the primary and the special,
yes.
It has to be within a certain amount of weeks.
So
it may not, depending on a lot of things, right?
Yeah, yes. So, and that would be this year's budget, not next year's.
Right.
So, and if we do have to have one of the elections or both of them, I'll have to come back and ask you for money this year. So it's something we can't help.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I appreciate you.
And your last budget of the evening is the Bathing Beach budget. It appears on page 139, and I see Chairman of the Bathing Beach Board of Trustees here. This is a pretty straightforward budget too. With a modest increase, actually it's a slight decrease year over year. Exact numbers. The budget request was $39,226. I approve the entire request. It's a $1,001 decrease year over year.
Pretty straightforward. I guess we're the least budget and the last on the your agenda, so I'll be brief.
Thank you.
Essentially, our budget was a little bigger last year because we're dealing with the goose control.
And we've maintained that.
And we've maintained that. So that's being maintained. The balance, it's almost 50-50 between what we do in physical things like goose control and keeping up the docks and personnel. And our personnel budget is obviously very limited. It's like 17,000-18,000, and it's between July 4th and Labor Day. And I would like to comment on Selectman Power's comment the other day. We do rely heavily on the engineering department. And they've been invaluable to me when I was on the Harbor Development Committee and as well the Bathing Beach Trustees. I think, you know, we're going to CPC this year. We'll probably be before you in a little while. You know, we're going to be looking to get some money as a seed money for us to build a bathhouse, marine center, whatever you want to call it. And Roger's office was instrumental in getting the grant application in. CPC seems open to it, and I think we've talked about the idea of doing it privately. We build a building, we get a vendor to come in. We've tried, as Paula Soto said, the Tom Sawyer approach. It didn't work, and we're trying to get somebody to build a building for us. But Rogers, we don't have any staff, so the fact that, you know, we can work that closely with the engineering department and has been invaluable to us. You know? I think it works well. We work well with him, but if we didn't have that as a resource, we'd be hard pressed to do what we're doing along the waterfront.
Thank you.
Yeah. That's it.
Thanks, Ellen.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Ellen.
Okay. All right. Ellen, your agenda.
All right. Votes.
Moving on, because we still have some miles to go before we sleep. Let's see. Appointments. Okay. I know that the sheet's been handed out to you guys, so if you could continue to think about that. Communicate your views to the town administrator. Hopefully we can get to that before the year's out. Ted? Which one do you want to take up? You want to take up the reserve fund transfer?
Yeah, why don't we do the votes and then...
Okay. You have a reserve fund transfer. I'm going to handle this for Chief Bob Olson today. This is repairs to the ladder truck, the Quint. We call it the Quint. As you can see in the memo, I'll read straight from it. The Quint failed the annual ladder test and needs to be repaired. It's the only aerial ladder the town has. It's a
core piece of material. It's been out for several months, and we're using mutual aid with other communities if we need one. They have been in front of Capitol to request the use of unspent capital money from this year's budget in the tune of $24,000, and that would reduce the transfer request to $51,000. The bill is $75,000. We do not maintain this kind of money in our repair maintenance vehicles, and we expect departments to come back for things like that.
Does that mean that this repair is going to ensure the longevity of that piece of equipment, or?
My understanding is that this will keep it on the same track that it is. I mean, it's nearing its useful life, but we're not ready to replace it, and it's a $1 million vehicle. So
$1 million.
Yeah. Okay.
Questions? Motion.
Make a motion to recommend a transfer from the reserve fund to R&M vehicles in the amount of $51,000.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So you have two votes regarding vehicles. Both of these are straight off of the capital funding plan that was approved at last town meeting. They're both over $50,000, so they're here in front of you for approval. They're both for vehicles within the DPW, one for $55,000 and one for $64,000.
Questions?
And the bids were pretty much, they pretty much were?
They were done through a cooperative bid through Plymouth County, so a larger grouping.
And the amount of the bid was pretty much in line with the capital outlay estimates?
Yes, yes.
Looks like it's, these vehicles are capable of multiple different uses too, based on the equipment
yeah.
that's on them.
Yep. This is core vehicles for the
sure.
DPW.
Yep. Can I have a motion, please?
Sure. Make a motion to approve the agreement with Liberty Chevrolet of Wakefield, Mass. In the amount of $55,075 for a 2015 four-wheel drive chassis one-ton truck for the DPW. And to approve the agreement with Liberty Chevrolet of Wakefield, Mass. In the amount of $64,992 for a 2015 four-wheel drive chassis one-ton truck for the sewer department.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I'll entertain a motion to appoint Robert Hagan, Sewer Commission Chairman, to the Water Company Acquisition Study Committee.
Second.
So moved. A second. Would
all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Last possible vote. Again.
Just maybe instead of reading this vote, I might just ask if we're ready to vote this or we still need some time on this.
I will just say that I briefly read the paper today, and it seemed to indicate in the paper that we had all agreed to appoint somebody, and I just wanted to make it clear that that had not happened, that we were in a, I mean, it, I guess it happens from time to time, but in any event, as I've promised Mary I would do, I informed the office today of discussions that I've had, and which would indicate, as I've indicated last time, that it, that this decision won't be made probably until January because of what was requested of me. And so that's where we are.
So has the letter gone to the Ethics Commission?
It has not.
Okay, so do we know when it will? Because when the Ethics Commission gets it, they have 30 days, and I made this request 21 days ago, so I'm just conscious of the cumulative time. Hmm. When do we think it'll go to the Ethics Commission?
Just so you know, I did communicate with the office today to let you know the status, and as soon as I get it, it will go to the ethics. I mean, that's all I can tell you.
Do we know when we'll get it from council?
It'll be very soon.
Because I had, last week, Ted, I had asked that, we, if there was anything necessary we needed to do to make sure that that we could move this along.
Council hasn't asked us for anything, so.
Okay. I'm going to put this on the agenda again for next week, just in the hopes that we can at least report out that that we've taken all the steps that we need to here in the town, understanding that the Ethics Commission will, potentially take up to 30 days. But I hope it can get in there, and I would just ask Paul that if you need anything from Ted or Betty in order to facilitate that, you know, I'd hope we could all make it a priority.
And somebody should have told you, Mary, that on Friday, that based on a request from me, there was documents sent over to council on Friday.
Right.
So he was getting something.
Right. I'm just.
And then I called Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday to try to communicate. And
yeah.
We did talk just recently, and there was a step or two left that he
yep.
has to do. So, you know, just so you know. But I am doing what I told you. I communicate
I
with the
yep.
Selectman's office to let you know what's happening.
Okay. And I'm just say that I'm hoping that that letter will have gone to the Ethics Commission by next week, so that we can keep moving on the chief's request.
All right, let's move on to the town administrator / selectman reports. Anything you want to add there, Mr. Alexiades?
Nothing at this time.
Ms. Power?
Nope.
Just very briefly, and I mentioned it with seniors, with Barbara. I want to thank the police chief and the police department for once again entertaining and feeding our seniors. There was a full house at South Shore Country Club, and I was fortunate enough to be able to be there and enjoy some period of time with the seniors and with the police officers. And it really it was a fantastic, as it is every year, event. And certainly with the outfits everybody had on, with the buttons and so forth, Christmas spirit is alive and well in Hingham, so I was happy to be there.
I remember doing that myself as a young police officer, and it's a good tradition. I'm glad the department continues to do it.
Absolutely.
On that note, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to entertain a motion to enter into executive session for the purposes of considering the purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property, because discussion of this matter in open session may have a detrimental effect of the negotiating position of the town. We will not be entering executive session for purposes of discussing ongoing litigation with Aquarian Water. By roll call vote, starting with you, Mr. Gannon.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. And not to return to open session.
And we will not be returning to open session. Thank you for that.
Do we want to stay here? We have a fairly large crowd. Do you want to move in the back room, because I don't know if you'll fit all back there. They have a big committee, so.
You know,
I think you're all on the Affordable Housing Trust, right? Okay. So,
perfect.
Good night, everybody.
Good night,
thank you.
Folks.
I'm going to get Betty Foley. She's going to join us.